Sharanamaham Prapadye Dhyanam Vande Padmakaram Pannamadanam Saubhajyadam Bhajyadam Astabhyam Abhyapradam Hanigane Nana Vidhaya Bhusitam Vattabhisa Palapradam Harihara Brahmati Vittevitam Tashve Pankajasanka Padmanidhi Viryuktam Sadashakti Vihi Parasijanayane Sarojahaste Dhavalataranchu Gandhamalya Shobhe Bhagavati Harivallabhe Manogye Trihuna Bhutikari Prasida Mahyam Trikudim Vigudim Vijyan Sarva Bhutahita Pradam Shraddham Vibhutim Surabhin Namami Paramatmikam Vacham Padmalayam Padmam Suchim Swaham Sudham Sudham Dhanyam Hiranmahim Lakshmi Nitya Pushtam Vibhavarim Aditim Vigudim Vittam Vasudham Vasudharanim Namami Kamalam Kantam Kshamam Shirodatam Bhavam Anudraha Paramruddhim Anagham Harivallabham Ashokam Dutam Dittam Loka Shoka Vinashinim Namami Dharma Nilayam Karunam Loka Mataram Padma Priyam Padma Hastam Padma Kshim Padma Sundarim Padmod Bhavam Padma Mukhim Padma Nabhatriyam Dhanam Padma Maladharam Devim Padminim Padma Dandhinim Punyagandham Suprasannam Prasadadimukhim Prabham Namami Chandra Vadanam Chandram Chandra Sahodarim Chutubhujam Chandarupam Indiram Indu Sitalam Ahlad Jananim Pushtim Shivam Shivakarim Satim Himalam Vishta Jananim Pushtim Daridjanashinim Priti Pushkaranim Shantam Shuklamaryam Varam Shriyam Bhaskarim Kalvanilayam Vararuham Vishatrinim Vasundaram Udarangam Harimim Hema Malinim Dhanadharni Karim Siddhim Shrena Somnyam Shubhapradam Nupaveshma Gatanandam Varalakshmim Vasupradam Subham Hiranya Prakaram Samudra Tanayam Jayam Namami Mangalam Devim Vishnu Vakshasthalasitam Vishnu Patnim Pasannakshim Narayana Samasitam Daridhyam Chanim Devim Sarbo Padravavarinim Namadurgam Mahakalim Brahma Vishnu Shivatmikam Trikalajyana Sampannam Namami Bhuvaneshwarim Lakshmim Kshira Samudra Rajatanayam Sriranga Dhabeshwarim Dasi Bhuta Samasudevanitam Lokaikadipam Puran Sriman Nandakatakshara Brahmendra Gangadharam Swandre Loki Kutumbinim Sabdijam Vande Mukundakriyam Matan Namami Kamale Kamalayatakshi Shri Vishnu Hukkaravasini Vishwamataha Shirodaje Kamalako Malagar Bhagavari Lakshmi Prasida Sotam Namatam Sharanyi Om Uklam Baradharam Vishnum Sashivarnam Chaturbhujam Vasat Namadanam Dhyaye Sarva Vigno Prasantaye Yasya Dhrita Vakkadhyā Parishiddhā Parasutam Vignam Nignam Suratam Vishvaksenam Tamashraye Vyasam Vashishta Naptam Shakte Patramakalmasam Parasharat Majambande Sukatasukatatam Tapo Nidhim Vyasa Vishnu Rupaya Vyasa Rupaya Vishnave Namo Vaidram Mahidaye Vashishtaya Namo Namaha Avikara Shuddhaya Hityaya Paramatmane Sadeka Rupa Rupaya Vishnave Sarva Vishnave Yasya Smarana Matrena Janma Samsara Bandhanate Umuchyate Namastasme Vishnave Prabha Vishnave Om Namo Vishnave Prabha Vishnave Sri Vaishampayana Vacha Sutva Dharmana Teshena Pavanani Sarvasaham Vidhishthirasyam Tanavam Punareva Abhyabhasatam Vidhishthira Vacha Imekam Deva Tamloke Kimba Pekam Parayanam Tuvam Takkam Kamachanta Prasni Urmana Vashubham O Dharma Dharmanam Bhavata Paramomataham Kimte Panmucha Dejantur Janitara Bandhanate Sri Bhishnu Vacha Jagat Prabhum Deva Deva Manam Tam Purushottamam Suvan Nama Sahasrena Purushasthara Totthitaham Vintami Vacha Jernityam Bhaktya Purushamavyayam Jhyayam Stuvan Namasyam Sya Manastami Vacha Anadhinidhanam Vishnum Sarva Loka Maheshwaram Loka Dhyaksham Stuvan Nityam Sarva Dukhadigo Bhavet Brahmanyam Sarva Dharmanam Loka Nam Kirti Vardhanam Loka Natham Mahattam Sarva Bhuta Bhavod Bhavam Teshame Sarva Dharmanam Dharma Adhikatamo Mataham Yad Bhaktya Pundarika Aksham Sadai Rachena Rasadam Paramanyo Mahatteja Paramanyo Mahattapaham Paramanyo Mahatrahma Paramanyakparayanam pavitranam pavitramyo mangalanam cha mangalam devatam devatanam cha bhutanam yo avyayam pitam etas sarvani bhutani bhavantyadi yugagame yasmin cha pralayamyanti punareva yugakshaye tasya loka pradhanasya jagannathasya bhupate vishnon nama sahasram me shunu papa bhayapaham yani namani gonani vikhyatani mahatmanah ushibhikpari gitani tani vakshami bhutaye vishnon nama sahasrasya vedavyaso mahan yushihi chatonishtipudhadevo bhagavan devakirtaham amutanshudbhavo bijam shaktir devakinandanaham Prasamahi Devatasya Chante Devi Niyujyate Vishnum Vishnum Mahavishnum Brahavishnum Maheshwaram Aneka Rupa Daityamantam Namami Purushottamam Asya Sri Vishnu Divya Sahasranam Stotra Mahamantrasya Sri Vedavyaso Bhagavan Rishihi Anushyachandaha Sri Mahavishnu Paramatma Sriman Narayana Devata Amrutam Shudbhavo Bhanuriti Bijam Devaki Nandana Shrashteti Shaktihi Udbhavak Shobhana Devaiti Paramo Mantraha Shankadam Nandaki Chakriti Kilakam Shankadam Vagada Dharityastram Uthanga Panik Shobhyati Netram Uchama Samagatsani Tiracham Anandam Parabramhuti Anahi Utuhu Sudarshana Kalaiti Digbandaha Sri Vishwarupaiti Dhyanam
Sri Mahavishnu Kahikarya Rupe Sri Govinda 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 Sri Mahavishnu Agnaya Pravartamanasya Adya Brahmanaha Dvitiya Parardhe Sri Sweta Varaha Kalpe Vaivasvata Manvantare Kaliyuge Pradhama Pade Jambu Dvipe Bharata Varshe Bharata Khande Krauncha Dvipe Ramanaka Varshe Aindra Khande America Dese Illinois Pradese Chicago Nagarataha Asmad Gruhe Asmad Vasati Gruhe Bhagavad Bhagavata Charya Sannidhau Asmin Vartamana Vyavaharika Prabhuvadi Shashti Samhattaranam Madhye Sri Sarvalinama Samhattare Uttarayane Sisire Ruto Phalguna Mase Bahula Pakshe Chaturdasyam Tidhau Subhanakshatre, Purva Bhadra Nakshatre, Prapurvahne, Purva Bhadra Nakshatre, Idani Muttara Bhadra Nakshatre, Hanumat Masa Nakshatra Mahotave, Acharya Sri Sri Tidandi Simanna Rana Ramanuja Peddaji Swaminaha Masa Nakshatra Mahotave, Uttara Bhadra Nakshatre, Subhavasare, Stiravasare, Sirivasare, Dvitiya Srinivasare Mase Mase Tara Devi Damid Tara Devi Masa Smaraka Sabha Mahotsave Seta Tamamara Smaraka Sabha Mahotsave Dvitiya Srinivasare Subha Sandhyayam Sayam Sandhyayam Srinivasa Ramanuja Antarjatiya Pravachana Goshti Sadasya Vyasa Kutumbasya Kshema Sthairya Dhairya Virya Vijaya Abhaya Ayuhu Arogya Aishwarya Abhirudhyardham Achandrarkam Vamsha Abhirudhyardham Manu Abhilashata Kamana Siddhyardham Satsantana Praptyardham Satsantana Abhirudhyardham Kalyana Parampara Siddhyardham Rajadvare Rajagurhe Karyalaye Vaidyalaye Vidyalaye Sarvato Mukha Abhiruddhi Siddhyardham Bhagavad Bhagavad Acharya Kainkarya Parata Siddhyardham Sayam Kale Hanuman Chalisa Yukta Sri Vishnu Sahasranam Parayanam Acharya Mukhena Karayishye Dhyanam
Shiro Dhanvapradeshe Suchimani Virasat Chaikate Mautikanam Mala Klipta Samastha Spadikavani Bhair Mautiker Manditangaha Shubhrair Abhrair Adabhrair Upari Virajite Mukta Piyusha Varshai Anandi Nakuniya Arinayna Gada Shankha Panir Mukunda Uppado Yasyana Bhir Veda Suranda Chandra Suryo Chanetre Karna Vasa Shirojyo Mukha Vidhano Yasya Vaste Yamadhihi అంతస్థం యస్య విశ్వం సుర నరక యోగో భోగి గంధర్వ దైత్యైః చిత్రం రమ్యతే తం త్రిభువన వృషం విష్ణుమీశం నమామి శాంతాకారం భుజగసేనం పద్మనాభం సురేశం విశ్వాకారం గగన సదృశం మేఘవర్ణం శుభాంగం లక్ష్మీకాంతం కమలనయనం యోగ్యహృద్ధ్యానగమ్యం వందే విష్ణుం భావాభయహరం సర్వలోకైకనాథం మేఘశ్యామం పీతకోసేయవాసం శ్రీవత్సాంకం కౌస్తుభోద్భాసితాంగం పుణ్యోపేతం పుండరీకాయతాక్షం విష్ణుం వందే సర్వలోకైకనాథం శశంఖచక్రం సకిరీటకుండలం సపీతవస్త్రం సరసీనిరుహేక్షణం సహారవస్తక్షస్థలశోభికౌస్తుభం నమామి విష్ణుం శిరసా చతుర్భుజం
హరి ఓం విశ్వం విష్ణు శక్కారో భూతభవ్యభవత్కవో భూతాత్మా పరమాత్మా చ ముక్తానాం పరమాగతే
అవ్యయ పురుష సాక్షే క్షేత్రజ్ఞో క్షరేవ చ
యోగో యోగమిదాం నేతా ప్రధాన పురుషేశ్వరః
నారసింహ శ్రీమాన్ కేశవ పురుషోత్తమః
అప్రమేయో ఋషికేశ పద్మనాభో అమర ప్రభు
విశ్వకర్మాధ్రువ
అగ్రాహ్య శాశ్వత కృష్ణో లోహితాక్ష ప్రదర్శన ఈశాన ప్రాణజ ప్రాణో జేష శ్రేష ప్రజాపతి ఈశ్వరో విక్రమే దన్వే మేధావీ విక్రమ క్రమ
అనుత్తమోరాత్మవాన్
లోకాధ్యక్షరాధ్యక్షర్మాధ్యక్షత్మాచర్వ్యూహ
అతీంద్రియోహోత్సాహోబల
మరీచర్దమనో హంసా సుపర్ణో భుజగోత్తమ
హిరణ్యనాభ
అమృత్య సర్వదృక్ సింహ సంధాతా సంధిమాన్ స్థిరః
అజో దుర్మర్శన శాస్తా విశుతాత్మా సురారిహ
గురు గురు తమో నామ సత్య సత్య పరాక్రమః
నిమిషో అనిమిషస్త్రీవాచస్మృతిర్ధారధి
అగ్రణీ గ్రామణీ శ్రీమాన్ న్యాయో నేత సమీరణః
సహస్రమూర్ధ విశ్వాత్మా సహస్రాక్ష సహస్రవాద్
ఆవర్తనాని
వృత్తాత్మ సమృద సంప్రమత్తన అహ సంవర్తకో వన్నీ అనిలో ధరణీధర
ಸುಪ್ರಸಾದ ಪ್ರಸನ್ನಾತ್ಮ ವಿಶ್ವ ದೃಕ್ ವಿಶ್ವ ಭುಕ್ ವಿಭು
ಸತ್ಕರ್ತ ಸತ್ಕೃತ ಸಾಧು ಜಿನ್ನು ನಾರಾಯಣ ಹೊಂದರ
ಅಸಂಖ್ಯೇಯೋ ಅಪ್ರಮೇಯಾತ್ಮ ವಿಶಿಷ್ಟ ಶಿಷ್ಟ ಕೃಚ್ಯತೆ
ಸಿದ್ಧಾರ್ಥ ಸಿದ್ಧ ಸಂಕಲ್ಪ ಸಿದ್ಧಿ ಸಿದ್ಧಿ ಸಾಧನ
ವೃಷಾಹಿ ವೃಷಭೋ ವಿಷ್ಣುರ್ ವೃಷಪರ್ವಾ ವೃಷೋದರ ಓಜಸ್ತೆಜೋದ್ಯುತಿಧರ ಪ್ರಕಾಶಾತ್ಮ ಪ್ರತಾಪನ ಅಮೃತಾಂಶೋದ್ಭವೋ ಭಾನೋ ಜಸಬಿಂದು ಸುರೇಶ್ವರ
ಔಷಧಂ ಜಗತಸ್ಯೇತು ಸತ್ಯಧರ್ಮ ಪರಾಕ್ರಮಃ
ಭೂತಭವ್ಯ ಭವನ್ನಾಥ ಪವನ ಪಾವನೋ ನಲ
ಕಾಮಃ ಕಾಮಕೃತ್ಯಾಂತ ಕಾಮ ಕಾಮಪ್ರದ ಪ್ರಭುಃ
ಯುಗಾದಿ ಕೃತ್ಯುಗಾವರ್ತೋ ನೈಕಮಾಯೋ ಮಹಾಸನಃ
ಅದೃಶ್ಯೋ ಅವ್ಯಕ್ತ ರೂಪಸ್ಯ ಸಹಸ್ರಜಿತ್ ಅನಂತಜಿತ್
ಇಷ್ಟೋ ವಿಶಿಷ್ಟ ಶಿಷ್ಟೇಷ್ಟ ಶಿಖಂಡೀ ನೌಷೋ ವೃಷ
ಕ್ರೋಧಕೃತ್ಯುತ
ಪ್ರದಿತ ಪ್ರಾಣ ಪ್ರಾಣದೋ ವಾಸಭಾನುಜ
ಅಪಾಂ ನಿಧಿಷ್ಠಾನಮ ಪ್ರಮತ್ತ ಪ್ರತಿಷ್ಠಿತ
ಸ್ಕಂದ ಸ್ಕಂದದರೋ ದುರ್ಯೋ ವರದೋ ವಾಯು ವಾಹನ
ವಾಸುದೇವೋ ಬೃಹದ್ಭಾರಂ ವಾಯುದೇವ ಪುರಂದರ
ಅಶೋಕಸ್ತಾರಣಸ್ತಾರ ಶೂರಶೌರ್ಯರಚನೇಶ್ವರ
ಅನುಕೂಲಶ್ಚತಾವರ್ತ ಪದ್ಮೇ ಪದ್ಮನಿಭಿಕ್ಷಣಃ
ಪದ್ಮನಾಭೋ ಅರವಿಂದಾಕ್ಷ ಪದ್ಮಗರ್ಭಶರೀರಭೃತ್
ಮಹಾಧೀರ್ಘವೃದ್ಧಾತ್ಮ ಮಹಾಕ್ಷೋ ಗರುಡಧ್ವಜಃ
ಅತುಲಸ್ವರಭೋ ಭೀಮಸ್ಸಮಯಜ್ಞೋ ಹವಿರ್ಹರಿಃ
ಮಹೀಧರೋ ಮಹಾಭಾಗೋ ವೇಗವಾನ
ಉದ್ಧವ ಕ್ಷೋಭನೋ ದೇವ ಶ್ರೀಗರ್ಭ ಪರಮೇಶ್ವರ
ಕರಣಂ ಕಾರಣಂ ಕರ್ತಾ ವಿಕರ್ತಾ ಗಹನೋ ಗುಹಃ
ವ್ಯವಸಾಯೋ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥಾನ
ಪರರ್ಧೀ ಪರಮಸ್ತೃಷ್ಟುಭೇಕ್ಷಣ
ರಾಮೋ ವಿರಾಮೋ ವಿರತೋ ಮಾರ್ಗೋ ನೇಯೋ ನಯೋ ನಯ
ವೀರಸ್ಯ ಕಿಮತಾಂ ಶ್ರೇಷ್ಠೋ ಧರ್ಮೋ ಧರ್ಮವಿದುತ್ತಮಃ
ವೈಕುಂಠ ಪುರುಷ ಪ್ರಾಣ ಪ್ರಾಣದ ಪ್ರಣವ ಪೃಥು
ಹಿರಣ್ಯಗರ್ಭಸ್ತೋ ವ್ಯಾಪ್ತೋ ವಾಯುರದೋಕ್ಷಿಲ
ಸುದರ್ಶನ ಪರಮೇಷ್ಠಿ ಪರಿಗ್ರಹ
ಉಗ್ರ ಸಂಹತ್ಸರೋ
ಪ್ರಮಾಣ ಬೀಜಮವ್ಯಯಂ
ಅರ್ಥೋ
ಮಹಾಭೋಗೋ ಮಹಾಧನ
ಅನಿರ್ವಿನ್ನಷ್ಟ ವಿಷ್ಣೋಭೂರ್ಧರ್ಮಯೂಪೋ ಮಹಾಮಕ
ಸುಹೃದ
ಸುಮುಖ ಸೂಕ್ಷ್ಮ ಸುಘೋಷ ಸುಖದ
ಮನೋಹರ
ಸ್ವಾಪನ ಸ್ವಶೋ ವ್ಯಾಪಿ
ಗಭಸ್ತಿನೇಮಿ
ಸತ್ವಸ್ಥಃ ಸಿಂಹೋ ಭೂತ ಮಹೇಶ್ವರ
ಆದಿದೇವೋ ಮಹಾದೇವೋ ದೇವೇಶು ದೇವದೃತ್ತುರುಃ
ಉತ್ತರೋ ಗೋಪದೀರ್ಘೋಕ್ತ ಜ್ಞಾನಗಮ್ಯ ಪುರಾತನ
ಶರೀರಭೂತ
ಭೂರಿ ದಕ್ಷಿಣ
ಸೋಮಪೋ ಅಮೃತಪ ಸೋಮ ಗುರುಜಿತ್ಪುರು ಸತ್ತಮ
ವಿನಯೋ ಜಯ ಸತ್ಯ ಸಂಧೋ ದಾಸಾರಕ್ತ ಪ್ರದಾಂಪತಿ
ಜೀವೋ ವಿನಯಿತ ಸಾಕ್ಷಿ ಮುಕುಂದೋ ಅಮಿತ ವಿಕ್ರಮ ಅಜೋ ಮಹಾರಸ್ವಾಭಾವಿಯೋಜಿತ ಮಿತ್ರ ಪ್ರಮೋದನ
ಆನಂದೋ
ಮಹರ್ಷಿ ಕಪಿಲಾಚಾರ್ಯ ಕೃತಜ್ಞೋ ಮೇದಿನೀಪತಿ ಮಹಾವರಾಹೋ ಗೋವಿಂದ ಸುಸೇನ ಕನಕಾಂಗದೆ
ಗುಹ್ಯೋಧರ
ವೇದ ಸ್ವಾಂಗೋ ಅಜಿತ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ದೃಢ ಸಂಕರ್ಷಣೋ ಅಚ್ಯುತ ಭಗವಾನ್ ಭಗಾನಂದೇ ವನಮಾಲೇ ಹಲಾಯುಧ
ಆದಿತ್ಯೋ ಜ್ಯೋತಿರಾದಿತ್ಯ ಸಹಿಷ್ಣುರ್ಗತಿ ಸಪ್ತಮಃ
ಸುಧನ್ವಾ ಖಂಡಪರಶುರ ಧಾರಣೋ ದ್ರವಿಣಪ್ರದಃ
ದಿವ್ಯಕ್ಷರತ್ ಸರ್ವಜ್ಞಾಸೋ ವಾಚಸ್ಪತಿರಯೋ ನಿಜಃ
ಕೃತಾಮಾಸಾಮಘಸ್ಸಾಮ ನಿರ್ವಾಣಂ ದೇಶಜಂಬಿಶಕ್ತೆ
ಸನ್ಯಾಸಕೃತ್ಯಮಶಾಂತೋ ನಿಷ್ಠಾ ಶಾಂತಿಪರಾಯಣಃ
ಶ್ರೀನಿವಾಸಃ
ಶ್ರೀಧರ ಶ್ರೀಮಾನ್ಲೋಕತ್ರಯಾಶ್ರಯಃ
ಸ್ವಕ್ಷ ಸ್ವಂಗಸದಾನಂದೋ ನಂದಿಜ್ಯೋತಿರ್ಗಣೇಶ್ವರಃ
ವಿಜಿತಾತ್ಮಾ ವಿಧೇಯಾತ್ಮಾ ಸತ್ಯೇತಿಚ್ಛಿನ್ನ ಸಂಶಯಃ
ಉದೀರ್ಣ ಸರ್ವದಶ್ಚಕ್ಷುರನೀಶ ಶಾಶ್ವತಸ್ಥಿರಃ
ಭೂಷಯೋ
ಭೂಷಣೋ ಭೂತಿವಿಶೋಕಶೋಕನಾಶನಃ
ಅಚ್ಯುಷ್ಮಾನ್ ಅಚ್ಯುತ ಕುಂಭೋ ವಿಶುದ್ಧಾತ್ಮಾ ವಿಶೋಧನ
ಅನಿರುದ್ಧ
ಪ್ರಕೃತಃ ಪ್ರದ್ಯುಮ್ನೋ ವಿಕ್ರಮ
ಕಾಲನೇಮಿನಿ ಶೌರಿ ಶೂರ ಶೂರಜನೇಶ್ವರ
ತ್ರಿಲೋಕಾತ್ಮೇಶ
ಹರಿ
ಕಾಮದೇವ ಕಾಮಪಾಲ ಕಾಮೀ ಕಾಂತ ಕೃತಾಗಮ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮಣ್ಯೋ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ಕೃತ್ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ವಿವರ್ತನ
ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ವಿಬ್ರಾಹ್ಮಣ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮೇ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮಣ್ಯೋ ಬ್ರಾಹ್ಮಣ ಪ್ರಿಯ
ಮಹಾಕ್ರಮೋ ಮಹಾಕರ್ಮ ತೇಜ ಮಹೋರಗ
ಮಹಾಕೃತುರ್ಮಹಾಯಜ್ವಾ ಮಹಾಯಜ್ಞೋ ಮಹಾಹವೇ
ಸವ್ಯಸ್ತವ ಪ್ರಿಯ ಸ್ತೋತ್ರಂ ಸ್ತುತಿ ಸ್ತೋತಾರಣ ಪ್ರಿಯ
ಪೂರ್ಣ ಪೂರೈತ ಪುಣ್ಯ ಪುಣ್ಯ ಕೀರ್ತಿರ್ನಾಮಯ
ಮನೋಜವಸ್ತೀರ್ಥಕರೋ ವಸುರೇತ ವಸುಪ್ರದ
ವಸುಪ್ರದೋ
ವಸುದೇವೋ ವಸುರ್ವಸುಮನಾಹವಿಃ
ಸದ್ಗದಿಃ ಸತ್ಕೃತಿಃ ಸತ್ತಾ ಸದ್ಬೋಧಿಃ ಸತ್ಪರಾಯಣಃ ಭೂತಾವಾಸೋ ವಾಸುದೇವಃ ಸರ್ವಾಸು ನಿಲಯೋ ನಲಃ
ದರ್ಪಃ
ದರ್ಪಃ ದುಃಖರೋಧ ಪರಾಜಿತಃ
ವಿಶ್ವಮೂರ್ತಿರ್ಮಹಾಮೂರ್ತಿರ್ದೀಪ್ತಮೂರ್ತಿರ
ಮೂರ್ತಿಮಾನ್ಯ
ಮಾನದೋ ಮಾನ್ಯೋ ಲೋಕ ಸ್ವಾಮಿ ತ್ರಿಲೋಕ ಧೃತ್
ಸುಮೇಧಾ ಸತ್ಯಮೇಧಾ ಧರಾಧರ
ತೇಜೋ ವೃಷೋ ದ್ಯುತಿಧರ ಸರ್ವಶಸ್ತ್ರಭೃತಾಂಬರ
ಪ್ರಗ್ರಹೋ ನಿಗ್ರಹೋ ವ್ಯಗ್ರೋ ನೈಕಶೃಂಗೋ ಗದಾಗ್ರಜಃ
ಚತುರ್ಮೂರ್ತಶ್ಚತುರ್ಭಾ चतुरात्मा चतुर्भाव चतुर्वेद विदेक पात् समावर्तो निवृत्तात्मा दुर्जयो दुरतिक्रमः
दुर्लभो
दुर्गमो दुर्गो दुरावासो दुरारिः शुभाङ्गो लोकसारङ्गः सुतन्तु स्तन्तु वर्धनः
इन्द्रकर्मा
महाकर्मा कृतकर्मा कृताजमः उद्धवः सुन्दरः सुन्दोरत्तनाभः सुरोचनः
अर्को
वादकी जयत सर्वविद्यै सुवर्णबिन्दुरक्षोभ्य सर्वभागीश्वरेश्वरः
महारदो
महागतो महाभूतो महानिधिः कुमुद कुन्दर कुन्द पर्जन्य पावनोऽनिलः
अमृतांशोऽमृतवपुः
सर्वज्ञः सर्वतो मुखः सुलभः सुबृदः सिद्धः शत्रुजिच्छत्रुतापनः
निशूदनः
सहस्रार्च सप्त जिह्वा सप्तैधा सप्त वाहनः अमूर्त्यनुभवचिन्त्यो भयकृद्धरनाशनः अनर्बृहत्कृशस्थूलो गुणभिर्निर्गुणो महान्
अद्रुतस्वाचः
प्राग्वंशो वंशवर्धनः भारभृत्कथितो योगी योगी स सर्वकामदः
आश्रमः
श्यामः सुपर्णो वायुवाहनः धनुर्धरो धनुर्वेदो दण्डो दमयिता दमः
अपराजितः
सर्वतो नियन्ता नियमो यमः सत्त्ववान् सात्विकः सत्य सत्यधर्मपरायणः अभिप्रायप्रीतिवर्धनः विहाय सगतिर्ज्योतिसुरुचिरुतभुग्भुः
कविर्विरोचनः
सूर्या सविता रविलोचनः अनन्तऋतबुद्भोक्ता सुखदो नैकदोऽग्रजः
अनिर्विण्णकुदावशी
लोकाधिष्ठानमद्भुतः सनातनतमः कपिलः कपिरव्ययः
स्वस्ति
स्वस्ति दक्षिणः अरौद्रकुण्डली चक्री
विक्रम्योर्जितशासनः
शिशिरः सर्वरीकरः अक्रूरपेशलो दक्षो दक्षिणक्षुमिनाम्बरः
विद्वत्तमो
वीतभयः पुण्यश्रवणकीर्तनः उत्तारणो दुष्कृतिः पुण्यो दुःस्वप्ननाशनः
वीरः
रक्षणस्तो जीवनः पर्यवस्थितः अनन्तरूपो अनन्तश्रीरजितमन्युर्भयापहः
चतुरस्रो
वीरात्मा विदिशो व्याधिशो दिशः अनादिरभुर्भुवो लक्ष्मी सुवीरो रुचिराङ्गदः
जननो
जननिर्मादिर्भीमो भीमपराक्रमः आधारनिलयो धातः पुष्पः सप्रजागरः
उद्धरः
सत्तदाचारः प्राणदत्तनवत्पनः प्रमाणम् प्राणनिलयः प्राणभृत्प्राणजीवनः
तत्त्वम्
तत्त्वविवेकात्मा जन्ममृत्युजरातिगः भूर्भुवः स्वस्तरुस्तारः सविता प्रपितामहः
यज्ञो
यज्ञपतिर्यज्वा यज्ञाङ्गो यज्ञवाहनः यज्ञभुर्यज्ञभुग्यज्ञी यज्ञभुर्यज्ञसाधनः यज्ञान्तकृत्यज्ञगुह्यमन्नमन्नादेव च आत्मयोनिस्वयं जातो वैकान सामगायनः
देवकीनन्दनश्रेष्ठापनाशनः
शङ्खभृन्नन्दकी चक्री शारङ्गधन्वागदादरः
रथाङ्गपाणिभ्यः
सर्वप्रहरणायुधः शङ्खभृन्नन्दकी चक्री शारङ्गधन्वागदादरः रथाङ्गपाणिभ्यः सर्वप्रहरणायुधः श्री सर्वप्रेरणायुधवोम् नमः इति
वनमाली
गदीशाङ्गी शङ्खी चक्री च नन्दकी
श्रीमान्नारायणो विष्णुः
वासुदेवो अभिरक्षतु। Vanamali Gadi Sangi Pinky Chikri Chanandaki
Sriman Narayana Vishnu
Vasudevo Abhirakshato
Govinda Hari Govinda Govinda Hari Govinda It is him.
Kirtaniyachya Kesavachya Mahatmanah Namnam Tahasram Divyanam Asheshena Prakirtitam Yeidam Shunyam Nityam Yachavivarikitaye Nashukam Prapniya Kirchit Somutriya Chamanavah Vedanta Brahmanasya Kshatriyo Vedanta Brahmanasya Kshatriyo Sudhi Bhavet Vaisya Dhanatamuddhasya Kudrasya Pahumapniya Dharmati Prapniya Dharma Matati Chathamapniya Kamana Vapniyat Kami Prajati Chapniyat Prajaham Bhakti Manisadottaya Suchistad Gatamanasa Sahasram Vasudevasya Namnamita Prakirtet Vishaprapnoti Vipulamyati Pradhanyamirucham Achalam Shiyamapnoti Shreya Prapnoti Nuttamam Nabhayam Vajudapnoti Vivyam Tejas Chavindate Bhavatyaro Bodhidiman Dalarupa Gunanmitaham Rogatto Muchyate Rogat Vaddho Muchyeta Vandhanat Vayan Mucheta Bhitasto Mucheta Apanapadaham Durgan Idhratyasho Purishapurishottavam Stuvan Namasasrena Nityam Bhakti Samanvitaham Vasudeva Shreyo Matyo Vasudeva Parayanaham Sarva Papam Shuddhatma Yati Brahma Sanatanam Na Vasudeva Bhaktanam Ashubham Vidyate Kvajadam Janam Rittijara Vyadhi Vayan Naivo Pajayate Namantam Adhiyana Shuddha Bhakti Samanvitaham Jetatusakshanti, Sridhatismutikitabe, Nakrodhurkamatsarian, Nalobo, Nashubhamatim, Dorantikutapunyanam, Rakthanam, Purishottame, Dosajandrakanakshatra, Kandishobhur Mahodadim, Vasudeva Chibirena, Vidutani Mahatmanaham, Sisurasuragandharvam, Sayakshuragarakshasam, Jagadvaseva Tadedam, Krishna Sucharacharam, Indriyanamino, Buddhi Sattvam, Tejo, Balamdhatihim, Vasudevatmakanyahu, Kshetram Kshetra Gyevacham, Sarvagamanam Achara Pathamam Parikalpitaham, Achara Pravo Dharma Dharma Saprahurachitaham, Vishyaptikaro Deva Mahabhuta Nidhatagaham, Jangama Jangamam Chedam Jagannarayanadhavam, Yogo Jnanam Vasankhyam Vidyashinta Adhikarmacham, Veda Shastrani Vidyanam Itatsarvam Janardhanat, Eko Vishnumad Bhutam Vitabhutam Anikasaham, Lokan Vyate Bhutatma Bhunte Vishu Bhagavyaham Nam Stavam Bhagavato Vishnu Vyase Nakitam Patitikshet Purushap Shwetatum Sukhamacham Vishveshwaramajam Devam Jagatapravam Bhajanti Pushkaraksham Mateyanti Parabham Mateyanti Parabham Onnahim Namahite Vajjanovacham Padma Patravishalaksha Padmanabha Suruttamam Aktanam Anurektanam Pratabhav Janabdanam Shri Bhagavan Vacham Namam Namasasrena Totumichita Pandava Swami Kena Slokena Sudevana Samseham Sudevana Samseham Namaite Vyasa Uvacham Vasanad Vasudevasya Vasudante Degatrem Sarva Bhutani Vasusti Vasudeva Namostate Sri Vasudeva Namostam Namaite Parvati Uvacham Keno Paina Laguna Vishnu Namasasragam Pakshite Pandite Nityam Sotumicha Nyaham Prabho Ishwara Uvacham Sri Rama Rame Tirame Rame Manorame Sahasra Nama Tattulyam Rama Nama Varaname Shri Rama Rama Rame Tirame Rame Manorame Sahasra Nama Tattulyam Rama Nama Varaname Shri Rama Nama Varananam Namaite Namo Vacham Namostananta Sahasra Muttaye Sahasra Padakshi Shuroru Bahave Sahasra Namne Purushaya Shasvate Sahasra Kote Vidharane Namaha Shri Sahasra Kote Vidharanam Namaite Sanjayuvacham, Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna, Yatra Patho Dhanudharaham, Yatra Shivajayo Bhutir Bhruvani Tirmatir Mamam, Shri Bhagavan Uvacham, Ananyaschinta Yantumam, Yejana Paritasute, Tesham Nityabhyuktanam, Yoga Kshemam Mahamyam, Paritranaya Sadhunam, Vinashaya Dushkutam, Dharma Samsthapanathaya Sambhavami Yuge Yuge, Atta Vishannaha Sigilascha Bhitaham, Boreshu Chavyajishu Vattamana Sankirtya Narayana Shabdamatram Mukta Dukkha Sukhino Bhavante Artha Vishannaha Sijilascha Bhita Boreshu Chavyajishu Vattamana Sankirtya Narayana Shabdamatram Mukta Dukha Sukhino Bhavante Yadakshara Vadadhrishtam Matra Himanti Yadhavet Tatsarvam Shamutam Deva Narayana Namastate Kayena Vacha Manasendriyeda Vidhyatmana Vatrikite Svabhavad Karomi Yadhyat Sakalam Parasmai Narayana Eti Samartayami Shriman Narayana Eti Samartayami Sarvam Sri Krishna Arpanamastu Om Asmat Guru Bhyo Namaha Iti Sri Mahabharate Shatasahasrikayam Itayam Vaiyasikyam Anushasanika Parvani Moksha Dharmi Sri Bhishma Yudhishthira Samvade Sri Vishnu Divya Sahasranam Stotranami Ikona Panchashatadika Shatatamo Adhyayaha Sarvam Sri Krishna Arpanamastu Om Asmat Guru Bhyo Namaha Shrimate
రామానుజాయ నమః అని ఎంతో భక్తి శ్రద్ధలతో అని ఈ ప్రత్యేకమైన రోజు ఈ సెకండ్ సాటర్డే నాడు ఒక సెలబ్రేషన్ ఈ శ్రీనివాస రామానుజ అంతర్జాతీయ ప్రవర్తన గోష్ఠికి తారాదేవి గారి యొక్క ప్రత్యేకమైనటువంటి ఆశీస్సులు పొందేటటువంటిది. అటువంటి దానిలో ఉత్తర పూర్వపీఠగా ఉత్తరపీఠగా అందించిన భాగ్యవంతుడు భాగవత చిరంజీవి సింహాల బాబు మంత్రభాగానే నేను ముందర అనేటువంటి అన్నటువంటి చిరంజీవి శ్రీనివాస ఆచార్యులు వారు మంత్రభాగాన్ని అందించారు ఈ విష్ణు సహస్రనామ పార కార్యక్రమం. ఇక ఈ విష్ణు సహస్రనామ కార్యక్రమం మనందరికీ కూడా హనుమాన్ చాలీసతోనే ముగిస్తాము. హనుమాన్ చాలీస అందించే భాగ్యము మనకి ఈరు శనివారం అనేసరికి ఆ తిరుమల అంతా కూడా ఇంత దివ్యంగా కొనసాగడానికి కారణం తిరుమల శ్రీనివాసునికి రక్షకగా రక్షణగా ఉన్నటువంటి హనుమస్వామి కదా. రండి రండి మరి ఆ తిరుమల శ్రీనివాసుని పేరుతో ఉన్నటువంటి శ్రీనివాస ఆచార్యుల వారు మనకి హనుమాన్ చాలీస అందిస్తారు ఈ రోజున. జై శ్రీమన్నారాయణ. శ్రీనివాస ఆచార్యులు
జై శ్రీమన్నారాయణ. శ్రీ గురు చరణ సరోజర నిజమన ముకుర సుధారి వర్ణౌ రఘుబర విమల జసు జోదాయక ఫలచారి బుద్ధిహీన తను జానికే సుమిరో పవన కుమార్ బాల బుద్ధి విద్యా దేవు మోహి అరౌ కలేశ వికార్ జయ హనుమాన్ జ్ఞాన గుణ సాగర జయ కపీసుడు లోక ఉజాగర రామదూత అతులత బలరామాన్య నిబుద్ధ పవన నామ మహావీర విక్రమ భద్రంగే కుమతి వార్ధమతికే సంగీ కంచన వర్ణ విరాజ సువేద కానన కుండల కుంజిత గేత ఆత్మభద్రోజాభిరాజేకాంతే మోజితనే ఉద్దా జయశంకర్ సుమన కేసరణ శ్రీ ప్రతాపమాజగవందన విద్యావాన వనీయ రుజాతుర రామకాజగర భేకోవాతర రవిచరిత్రధన భేకోరస్య రామలగ్న సీతామన రామచంద్రకే కాశవారేలా జీవనలగ్న జయాయ శ్రీ రఘుబీర హరిశ్వరులాయే రఘుపతి గీని భవత బడాయి తమ్మ ప్రేమర్ దైతమ బాయి సహస్రపదమితమ రోజ సకావై అతికై శ్రీపతి కంటలకావై రక్షకాహుకోడరణా జానకీ మాత రామ రసాయన తమరే భాష సదా రఘుపతి కే దాస తమరే వచన రామ గోపావై జన్మ జన్మకే దుఃఖ విసరావై అంతకాల రఘుపతి వృజాయి జన్మారి వర్తకాయి అవరు దేవత పినదరై హనుమరసై సర్వ సుఖకరై సంకట కటైమటై సమపీరా జోసుమరై హనుమత వల్లభీరా జయ 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 హనుమాన్ గుసాయి కృపాకరో గురు దేవకనాయి జోసుమార్ పాఠకుమై చూటై బంది మహాసతోయ్ జోయపడి హనుమాన్ చాలీసా హోయ్ సిద్ధి సాకి గౌరీసా తులసీదాస్ నదార్ జేరా కీ జేనా హృదయ మాడేరా పవనతనయ సంకట హరణ మంగళమూరతి రూప్ రామలగ్న సీత హృదయ బసవ సురభూప్
రామ లక్ష్మణ జానకి జయ బోలో హనుమానకి రామ లక్ష్మణ జానకి జయ బోలో
హనుమానకి
రామాయ రామభద్రాయ రామచంద్రాయ వేధసే రఘునాథాయ నాథాయ Sitaya Pataye Namaha Raja Ramachandra Bhagavan ki Jai Pavana Sita Hanuman ki Jai Om Tvamasmin Karya Niryoge Pramanam Hari Satama Hanuman Yatra Mahasthaya Dukha Kshayakaro Bhava Om Tvamasmin Karya Niryoge Pramanam Hari Satama Hanuman Yatra Mahasthaya Dukha Kshayakaro Bhava Sita Lakshmana Bharata Shatrughna Hanumat Sameta Sri Ramachandra Bhagavan ki
Jai
Pavana Sita Hanuman ki Jai ho మనకి హనుమాన్ చాలీస అవగానే నిత్యము కూడా పాట అందించే రాధారాణి గారు ఈ రోజు మనకి అందలేదు కనుక రాధారాణి గారి స్థానంలో మనకి ఈ రోజు ఒక నూతన గాయకి మనకి పరిచయం అవుతున్నారు. వారి పేరు సింధూర. ఎవరో తెలుసా వీరు? మన పద్మ పోలవరపు వారి యొక్క అమ్మాయి మనకి సింధూర. జయ శ్రీమన్నారాయణ. అర్యుదే
జయ శ్రీమన్నారాయణమ్మా.
జయ శ్రీమన్నారాయణ సింధూర. So you kindly give 2-3 words about your introduction. From where are you? Is it, I still remember, from Washington DC, is it?
Yes, amma.
Yeah, please.
Nenu Virginia lo untam amma.
Konja introduction cheppi
Sindhura Swami gari shishulamu memantha kuda maa amma garu swami gari shishulu akkadi nunchi mayam kuda aa paramparani follow avutu vastunnamu. చాలా సంతోషంగా ఉండిపోయింది నాకు పాట పాడగలిగే అవకాశం దొరికినందుకు.
ఈ గోష్ఠి మీకు ఎలాగ పరిచయం అయింది?
ఈ గోష్ఠి మా అమ్మగారు ఇక్కడ అమెరికా వచ్చినప్పుడు అనురాధ ఆంటీ ద్వారా అమ్మకి తెలిసింది అమ్మ. అక్కడి నుంచి అమ్మ రోజు సాయంత్రం పూట అలా గోష్ఠిలో పాల్గొనేవాళ్ళు. మేము కూడా వినేవాళ్ళం. అమ్మలా స్పీకర్లోనే పెట్టేది. మేము మామూలుగా పనులు చేసుకుంటూ అలా వింటూ ఉండేవాళ్ళం. బాగా అలవాటు. ముఖ్యంగా రాధారాణి గారి పాట బాగా వినేవాళ్ళం మేము. మా అమ్మగారు తెలిసి మరీ వినిపించేవాళ్ళు. లేకపోతే ఆవిడ ఇలా టెక్స్ అనుకుంటా ఉంటారు అని చెప్పి చాలా ఇంట్రెస్టింగ్ గా అనిపించేది. చాలా ఆనందంగా ఉన్నాం ఇప్పుడు నేను పార్టిసిపేట్ చేయడం.
చాలా సంతోషం. ఇక ఈ రోజు మనకి ఈ రోజు తారాదేవి గారి యొక్క 100వ స్మారక సభ. ఈ రోజు ఆ ప్రత్యేకతగా మన సింధూర ఒక చక్కని పాట అందిస్తారు. జయ సింహనారాయణ మా సింధూర.
అంతయు హరి పుండరీకాక్ష చింతనకు నీవే శ్రీ రఘురామయు హరి పుండరీకాక్ష చింతనకు నీవే శ్రీ రఘురామయు హరి పుండరీకాక్ష ఆ కులమున నీవే గోవిందుడా కలిమియు కరుణానిధి కులమును నీవే గోవిందుడా కలిమి మధుసూదనా తను మన నీవి
పరిపుండరు కక్ష చింతనకు హరిపుండరు కక్ష
మొట్టమొదటి రోజున అద్భుతమైన పాఠం అందించారు ఈ స్త్రీ ప్రవచన గోష్ఠి. మనకందరికీ కూడా ఈ ప్రత్యేకమైనటువంటిది సింధూరా మొట్టమొదటి రావడమే కాదు, అసలు ఎప్పటి నుంచో పరిచయం ఉంది అని చెప్పడంలో ఇంకా ఆనందంగా ఉంది మాకు. ఇక ఈ అద్భుతమైన పాఠం అందించే ఇలాగ మీరు ఎప్పుడెప్పుడు అవకాశం ఉందంటే, ముఖ్యంగా శనివారం మనకి ఎప్పుడూ ఒక సెలబ్రేషనే శనివారం, అందులోకి సెకండ్ సాటర్డే అంటే ఇక ఇది 100th సెకండ్ సాటర్డే ఈరోజు మనకి. అందుకని ఒక అంతవరకు 99 సెకండ్ సాటర్డేలు అంటే 99 నెలలు నిర్విఘ్నంగా కొనసాగించారు మన ఈ తారాదేవి గారి యొక్క సంతానం అందరూ. అయితే తారాదేవి గారు కేవలం ఆవిడ సంతానానికే పరిమితి కాకుండా ఈ గోష్ఠి కూడా ఆవిడ సంతానంగా భావించుకున్నటువంటి భావన కనుకనే ఈనాడు కూడా మనం అందరూ ఆవిడ గుర్తుపెట్టుకుంటున్నాము, ఆవిడ కోసం ప్రత్యేకంగా మనం తెలుసుకుంటున్నాము. రండి, ఈరోజు కేవలము తారాదేవి గారి స్మారక సభకిలో ఆవిడ జన్మదినం కూడా కలిసింది కనుకనే సింధూరా మనకి చక్కని పాట అందించారు. చాలా ఆనందం కలిగిందమ్మా, ఒక ప్రత్యేకమైనటువంటి గుర్తు ఉండిపోతుంది మాకు. జయ శ్రీమన్నారాయణమ్మ సింధూర, అనేక అనేక మంగళ అనేక అనేక మంగళ జయ జయ శ్రీమన్నారాయణ. ఇక మేము అభిరామ్ కిడాంబి ఫ్రమ్ లాస్ ఏంజలీస్, అభిరామ్ కిడాంబి ఈరోజు ప్రత్యేకంగా, మామూలుగా శుక్రవారమే మనకి అభిరాము నిరంతరము ప్రతి వారము కూడా శుక్రవారం రాగానే వేణుగానా అందించే వేణుగాన లోలుడా మనకి అనిపిస్తాడు అటువంటి అభిరామ్. ఈరోజు మనకి తారాదేవి గారి ప్రత్యేక స్మారక సభ, అందులోకి 100వ స్మారక సభ. ఈ ప్రత్యేకమైన దానికి మనకి 6:30 చికాగో సమయంలోనే భాగవతులు అందరికీ కూడా ఒక ఇన్విటేషన్, ఏమిటంటే పిలుపు, అందరికీ స్వాగతం పలుకుతున్నాము. 6:30 చికాగోలో అయింది అనగానే శ్రీమాన్ కృష్ణ మహేశ్వరి, శ్రీమాన్ కృష్ణ మహేశ్వరి మనకి బే ఏరియా నుండి ప్రత్యేకమైనటువంటి ఈ తారాదేవి గారి గోష్ఠిలో సిల్వర్ మనం ఇంకా ఎలా చెప్పాలి 100th సెకండ్ సాటర్డే అని తారాదేవి మెమోరియల్ లెక్చర్లోని వారు జర్నీ త్రూ శాస్త్ర, దట్ ఈస్ ద టాపిక్ జర్నీ త్రూ శాస్త్ర అనేటువంటి విషయాన్ని ఆంగ్ల భాషలో మనకు అందిస్తారు. వారి విషయాలు కూడా మనకి అందరూ కూడా వివరంగా అందిస్తారు, మనం తెలుసుకుందాం. రండి అభిరామ్ సిద్ధమా, జయ జయ శ్రీమన్నారాయణ. అభిరామ్ కిడాంబి జయ శ్రీమన్నారాయణ, జయ శ్రీమన్నారాయణ,
జయ శ్రీమన్నారాయణ.
ఏ పాట పాడుతున్నావు చెప్పి, పాట ప్రారంభించదన్నా.
పలుకే బంగారమాయన
Thank you.
జై శ్రీమన్నారాయణ.
జై జై శ్రీమన్నారాయణ. అభిరామ్ కిడాంబి ఫ్రమ్ లాస్ ఏంజలీస్. అండ్ బికాస్ ఆఫ్ ద స్పెషల్ డే టుడే, టుడే బింగ్ ద స్పెషల్ డే ఆఫ్ తారాదేవి స్మారక సభ, సెకండ్ సాటర్డే. సెకండ్ సాటర్డే ఈజ్ ఆల్వేస్ ఎ సెలబ్రేషన్ ఫర్ శ్రీ ప్రవచన గోష్ఠి. మార్నింగ్ వీ డిడ్ రైట్ ఫ్రమ్ 7 o'clock. సెవెన్ వీ డిడ్ సుప్రభాత సేవ బై శ్రీమాన్ ఆసి ప్రభాకర్ రెడ్డి గారు ఫ్రమ్ విశాఖపట్నం, ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్, ఇండియా. సో ఇన్ ద సేమ్ వే వీ హ్యావ్ సో మెనీ ప్రోగ్రామ్స్. అండ్ ఈవినింగ్ ఆల్సో టుడే ఎ న్యూ డివటీ, న్యూ కమర్, వీ కెన్ సే న్యూ కమర్ ఇస్ ఆల్వేస్ వెల్కమ్. ద సింధూరా sang first time in our goshti. We appreciate that. And now Abhiram, usually on Sunday and Fridays, but Saturday, in additional happiness of flute recital, we appreciate. Now we invite and request Dr. Raji Ananda. Raji Ananda from Los Angeles. Dr. Raji Ananda is also, really, she is a Carnatic singer. By profession, she is a neurologist. And apart from that, and she is a wife of a great scientist, NASA scientist, Dr. Mohan Anandaji. Mohan Anandaji was very familiar with our Sri Pravachana Goshti, and he gave several talks, and as recently he had a very good talk on Taradevi Memorial. First he started in the way, we can say that Mohan Ananda has inaugurated these talks. Earlier we used to have many people who used to come and say something. But in a professional way, we are started that, that is with the, starting with the Mohan Ananda on the Krishna Ashtami day. Sri Vaishnava Krishna Ashtami, we started this and it continues and without any interruption. After Mohan Ananda, Dr. R. Narayan Swami, Dr. R. Narayan Swami also from Los Angeles. And that was the talk after that Mohan Ananda ji. And after Dr. R. Narayan Swami ji, now today the talk will be by Sriman Krishna Maheshwari from Los Angeles, from Bay Area. And he will come in there. Now we invite Srimati Raji Ananda. Raji Ananda, Jaisimanarena, audio or video is a choice, is yours. Are you there in the Jaisimanarena? Srimate Rama, sir, maybe 5 minutes. Sri Rama Jaya Rama Jaya Jaya Rama, 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 Sri Rama Jaya Rama Jaya Jaya Rama. Today being the Uttara Bhadra Nakshatram, let me save till Raji comes for to sing. Let me recite something. శ్రీమన్నారాయణ యతివరు దీనవర్గే దయాళు, చోరాన్ బద్ధాన్ కఠిన నిగళై కర్మజై రామ భక్త్యా, ముక్తాన్ కర్తుం సపతి మధురా పట్టణే కేంద్రభూతే, కారాగారే క్రతుమయమధాం స్థాపయన్ సూపమేకన్. శ్రీమన్నారాయణ యతివరు దీనవర్గే దయాళు, చోరాన్ బద్ధాన్ కఠిన నిగళై కర్మజై రామ భక్త్యా, ముక్తాన్ కర్తుం సపది మధురా పట్టణే కేంద్రభూతే, కారాగారే కృతుమయ శ్మశాం స్థాపయన్ స్థూపమేకం. శ్రీరామనామని జయం సకలైర్విలేఖ్య, తద్వైభవం ప్రతిదినం మృదు బోధయత్వ, శ్రీరామరాధ్యమిహ భారత భూమి భాగే, యోగుష్యమాణమకరోత్ క్రతుభిర్యతీశః. శ్రీమాన్ త్రిదండి యతి శేఖర సార్వభౌమో వేదాంత యుగ్మ విదుషాం విదుషాం ప్రియాణాం సన్మాననం కృతువరే స్వధికృతువరేష్వధికం విధాయ భూయతే స్మ మహతే విభవాయ భూయః శ్రీమన్నారాయణ రామాన జతీంద్రవరభ్యో నమః. జయ జయ శ్రీమన్నారాయణ. టుడే వింగ్ ఉత్తరాభద్ర. So audio or video is a choice we have given to her. So in the yes, Mr. Shastri and Raja. Okay. Jai Jai Shrimanarayana. Alva Ambiramana Diya Divyadrugale Saranam. Jai Shrimanarayana. Dr. Raji, are you there? I could not hear your voice. Maybe. Jai Rama, Jai Rama, Jaya Jaya Rama, Sri 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 Rama, Jai Rama, Jaya Jaya Rama. Om Asmat Guru Bhyo Namaha. Sri Rama, Jaya Rama, Jaya Jaya Rama, Sri Rama, Jaya Rama, Jaya Jaya Rama, Sri Rama, Jaya Rama, Jaya Jaya Rama. Some of the things which we want to. And now coming the 18th of this month, one has to, 13th is the new Telugu year, the new Telugu year, that is Ugadi. Ugadi is on 13th, that is on Tuesday, the coming Tuesday, the Ugadi new Nutana Samhatsaram. And the 18th is Bhagavad Ramanujacharya's, Sauramana Bhagavad Ramanujacharya's birthday. And Chandramana we have on May 16th, that is on Sankara Bhagavatpada Jayanti, and Bhagavad Ramanujacharya Chandramana. So we feel Sauramana, that is Bhagavad Ramanujacharya, that is Meshe Ardram, when sun enters into the Mesha Rasi, that is on 13th, sun enters into Mesha Rasi, and when the Ardha Nakshatram, the star Ardra, that is Bhagavad Ramanujacharya's Avirbhavam. That is on this 18th of this Sunday, of 18th Sunday, that we always, we do celebrate. And from that day till May 16th, that is a lunar calendar, Ardra Nakshatram, and that is Vaishakha Masam, Ardra Nakshatram, after Akshaya Tritiya. Every year we used to celebrate that after Akshaya Tritiya, Bhagavad Ramanujacharya's lunar calendar celebration. So from this April 18th to May 16th, we do celebrate Bhagavad Ramanujacharya's life achievements and some of the things which invite some speakers from different places, from different languages, they come and speak. And yesterday we remember, from Bengali song, most of you have already heard that song by Srimati Subhra Chakravarti. She sang a Bengali song, and which we asked her to send the video, so she has sent that one. We have already put it in the, usually that we won't encourage, but for some different things we asked her to send the video. So now Dr. Raji, are you there? I could not hear. Jai Jai Shrimanarayana. Give me 5 minutes, she said. Jai Jai Shrimanarayana. Sri Rama, Jai Rama. Already 6:06. Okay. Till 6:30 we have time. So that we all see what are the things which we can learn about Bhagavad Ramanujacharya. Bhagavad Ramanujacharya left Srirangam and took refuge in Melkota. After 18 years of stay, in Melkota, Bhagavad Ramananda decided to come back to Sri Rangam. After Kirvikantha, the ruler was passed away. Then the devotees at Melkota were heartbroken and distraught. Bhagavad Ramananda consoled them, because when those who are in close relation with Bhagavad Ramananda, they don't want to leave him away or to be away from him. So really Bhagavad Ramananda consoled them. He gave some religious discourses before leaving Melkota. That is what the name of the book is called, Varta Mala. That is, Varta Mala is in a, has put together some discourses in the form of slokas. Among that, one sloka, just let us now discuss till the time is, our time is 6:30 is the time we have given for Sriman Krishna Maheshwari, and 6:20 to 25 is the time we have given to Dr. Raji Ananda. So before they come, then let us know something. Sri Vashya Dravidagama Pravachanam Sri Shastaleshvavnvaham Sri Vashya Dravidagama Pravachanam Sri Shastaleshvavnvaham Kainkaryam Yadushaila Nitya Vasati Kainkaryam Yadushaila Nitya Vasati Sardha Dvayocharanam Yadva Bhagavata Bhimana Vasati Yadva Bhagavata Bhimana Vasati Sreyas Satam Ityaram Sreyas Satam Ityalam Sishyan Prahayati Swaraha Paramagad Vishnu Padam Shashvatam Sishyan Prahayati Swaraha Paramagad Vishnu Param Shashvatam. Towards the end of his life, Bhagavad Ramanujacharya gave this teaching in the book Varta Mala to the distressed Prapanna, who, not being able to take to the path of karma, jnana and bhakti yoga, Bhagavad Ramanujacharya had done Varanyasam, that is prapatti, in the shrine of Lord Ranganatha by doing saranagati. He should not thereafter concern himself as to how the journey of the body will take place thereafter. He should conclude that by the grace of Ranganatha, it will be for his good only. One has to suffer lifelong the effects of the prarabdha karma. It is the agami karma and sanchita karma which will not stick to him. The meaning of this particular sloka: one should not be upset by sad events in his life or be overjoyed by the happy events which are the result of his own karma, since it is not possible to wish them away, one has to put up with them with patience. The treatment given by a doctor may be painful, but one has to put up with it so as to be get rid of the illness. Now we are meeting Srimati Dr. Raji Ananda, I remember doctor is the one. Vaidyo Narayano Harihi. Srimate Ram. Dr. Raji, can you hold the phone horizontal, please? Then the picture comes. Excellent. Hold it horizontal, not vertical. Kindly. Just see, we can see you here. It's coming. Srimate, can you hear my voice? Jai Jai Srimanarayana. ఆర్ యు దేర్ సీ yes it is coming and disappearing excellent dr raji excellent yeah please wow
huh? you have to unmute
eh? Please unmute from your side
there is a microphone icon.
Below.
Video.
Yeah, now yes. It's better. Yeah, now
we excellent. Can. Now we can hear. Okay. Wow. Okay. Dr. Raji Ananda.
I recorded because it's very difficult to hold and sing, so I recorded it. I am going to play. See whether you can hear. Can you hear?
Yes, we can hear.
Okay. अंगज
Thank you.
Jay Jay Siman Narayan.
I was going to ask you, Dr. Satyavadi, were you able to hear?
Yeah, I could hear. It was very with music. Your song itself is music, and with musical instrument. If the sound is very excellent, it has, we could hear.
Okay, thank you, Jayasim Narayana. This is the Tamil song in Kalyani Raga, composed by Pavanasam Sivan. Only reason, I just before I started the video, I had to record it because when I was last time, trying the video, the voice didn't come. So I wanted to make sure which way is better. So
the voice, this time it is better because this time we got the we could hear your voice so clear.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, so much. Immediately you could come in video. That's a great thing. Really, I really appreciate, and this is an inspiration to others. And also we request now. Dr. Mohan Ananda, and also we have a request. I have already mentioned to Dr. Narayan Swami. Yeah, Dr. Narayan Swami also we invited today, just to, your presence, because you have already earlier, they spoke on this Tara Devi lectures. So we want to, the previous lectures they had. So this, just to encourage the young man, who is Krishna Maheshwari, so I just want their presence, if they have no other occupation, other work.
We could probably, for the next few minutes, we can hear it just on the audio portion, because I have to drive to pick up something. Is that okay?
Not sure.
Okay. Yes, okay. Can we hear the audio portion by telebridge, or how do I do that?
Telebridge.
Okay, yes. I have the number. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, we will do that. Okay, because yes, I am available under.
And we have a lot more to talk about Krishna Maheshwari, but he is very humble and we did not take much. And really, he himself is an example of a living example. We always feel about him. So that we are so fortunate to be in connection, to be in contact with him.
I will leave the room and dial the telebridge, okay? And
yeah,
Mohan can hear also.
Yeah, please.
Okay.
And also,
okay.
I request Mohanji, I have already.
Namaste.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I have
Namaste,
already...
Namaste, auntie. I'm on.
Yeah.
Namaste.
Namaste. Namaste. Krishna Maheshwari is already here. Let us
welcome.
Jai Sri Krishna. Let us welcome Krishna Maheshwari. Jai Ho. Jai Jai Ho. And really, today being the 100th Tara Devi memorial lectures we always started on the second Saturday of the month. And this being the 100th second Saturday, that is a great...
Oh, wow. Okay.
100th month. And also today, a coincidence is the Srimati Tara Devi Gari's birthday. Though she has actually, she is in the Paramapadam. Still, we always feel the like Jayanti and Vardhanti, isn't it? So today is her Jayanti also, the day. We usually do Vardhanti, but Jayanti is also today her birthday. Date is also today. Her children, all the family were so happy and they were sharing their happiness with us. And they have already passed on your video to many of in the email. And also we requested Dr. Mohan Ananda and Dr. R. Narayan Swami, who were the previous guest speakers in our mainly. And many more spoke, but these two recent ones, we invited them to ask any questions. If there is not everyone really, sometimes they were not knowing how to handle the phone. Sometimes it may come disturbance and sounds. So that's why we asked.
Okay.
So now we invite Krishna Maheshwari to our Sri Pravachana Goshti. And we, before that, we invite Krishna Maheshwari is a friend of Srinivasa Kandala. Srini Kandala. Actually, it's a fortunate time we met him. And now, Chiranjeev Simha Kandala, Simha Sri Perumbudur Kandala, will give some introduction about Krishna Maheshwari. Then we request Krishna Maheshwari to start his topic on Journey Through Shastra. Yes,
thank you. Simha. Hi, Krishna. Welcome to Sri Pravachana Goshti. Today's speaker, as we all know, is Krishna Maheshwari from Santa Clara, California. And Krishna Maheshwari is the founder and CEO of Hindupedia, the online encyclopedia of Hindu Dharma. In addition to making an online encyclopedia, which is www.hindupedia.com, Hindupedia is engaged in driving textbook reform to remove Hindu-phobic and Indo-phobic content from textbooks. To this end, the Hindupedia team was successful in getting one publisher banned for their Hindu-phobic material for 10 years in California and instrumental in getting another publisher to drop out of social studies altogether. Hindupedia has also developed an alternate framework for how textbooks should cover Hindu dharma that has been backed by Hindu organizations representing over 1 million Hindus in the US. He has co-authored Making Children Hindu-phobic, a critical review of McGraw-Hill's World History textbooks, which is the first published work that does a formal critique of a textbook coverage of Hindu dharma. Krishna has co-founded several Hindu organizations in the past, including Cornell Hindu Student Council, which is also the Cornell Hindu Chaplaincy, Chinmaya Mission Seattle, ISKCON Bhakti Vriksha programs in Boston, San Jose and Seattle, and Yoga Bharati Seattle. He's an invited speaker on Hindu topics at conferences across the US. He has an MBA from Harvard Business School, masters and bachelor's from Cornell University in computer engineering and computer science. So the topic chosen today is Journey to Shastras. And we now request Mr. Krishna Maheshwari
Welcome, Krishna Maheshwari. And the proud parents.
Namaste, Jesse Krishna. Thank you.
Jesse Krishna. The proud parents, Shashi and Shastri Ji. And we appreciate his parents for bringing up the children in such a illustrious way. Yes, Krishna. Yes.
Okay, so let me share screen. All right, can everyone see my screen now? Just to check?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. And then do we have a way to take questions and answers from folks who are in the attendee, in the audience?
Oh, we have
Zoom.
That also is, we have Zoom.
Zoom
and
also we have sent to many.
We have Telebridge, which is an audio-only connection that people can, But
excellent.
Yeah.
So this talk and the talks that I give in general can be delivered in 30 minutes and be really boring, or they can take 5 hours and be really interesting. It totally depends on the folks that are listening to it and whether they are interested in engaging and asking questions along the way. No question is dumb. Every question is appreciated, and we prefer to go through and answer questions along the way. So for the end, we'll cover a fairly broad section of topics introducing various different types of Shastra and topics that most people don't do or are covered in. I don't feel it's not cumulative in the sense when you get to the end, we'll have covered a lot of different things. It's not like we're going very deep into any one particular topic. So again, ask questions along the way. And then if we can pause and introduce those questions along the way, Auntie, then that would be great. So when we talk about Shastra, what exactly is Shastra? Definitionally, Shastra refers to anything that's traditional. So what does that mean? It's a study, or if you will, or object, requires an exposition of something, so the study piece, the application of or a Shastra or tradition of that thing, or there, and then the other piece is study, which means and for development, which means that there's a specific approach to study that is also covered here. And so from that perspective, when you think about Shastra, there's a structure. It starts with an outlined goal. If you pick up any Shastra, it typically starts with, here's the thing you're going to learn. There's a set of postulates, right? A set of things that you assume are true at the beginning. There's a frame that defines the broad context that's covered. There's a set of sources that enable, there's a fundamental independent validation of anything that's covered. And then there are instructions to achieve that postulate that they defined. If you think of this as religion, then these definitions don't apply. Because when we assume religion, we assume dogma, and we assume we're told something and are forced to assume it to be true. If you look at the structure with a broader mind, you say, well, this actually looks like how we learned science back in elementary school. And if we continue down the sciences all the way through postgraduate, this is typically how sciences are approached, and scientific papers are approached, and scientific publications are approached. This is not something I'm coming up with either. And most of the things that we'll talk about today are not off, unquote, myself as the speaker. We're bringing out things that exist and have existed in Shastra for tens of thousands of years, if not longer. Now, what's a traditional subject? And I'm going to let this slide build out, but everything that's being shown here is considered a traditional subject. Unfortunately, it's also not a complete list. So again, when people think about traditional subjects and they think about Shastra, they don't equate it to these things. And frankly, some of these terms are newer than Shastra is, so these terms aren't used. Physics wasn't known as physics. A couple hundred years ago in the English, it's known as philosophy. Regardless of the English name of it, it is covered in Shastra. Meteorology is another one that was in this list. How do you predict the weather? How do you understand the weather? That wasn't known by that name for a long period of time. Encryption itself is a relatively recent field in the English language at any rate, but it's covered in depth in Shastra. When I say it's not a complete list, Shastra itself is such a broad set of materials that we couldn't possibly give a complete list because we don't know the complete list ourselves. A lot of Shastra simply doesn't exist, so we don't know what was in the pieces that didn't exist. We can only presume what we have and what we've received. So if we think about Shastra, somewhere in prehistory, there is actual discovery of content. And so as part of that discovery, these topics start being discussed. We can't date them, just there's too much time that's passed, and our sense of history doesn't allow us to do that. Now, in order to pass that discovery on, we needed education. And for education, we needed two other language and agriculture. If we didn't have agriculture, we'd be living in a nomadic from point to point.
So that's where agriculture was important, because you had people settled in a specific place and didn't have to roam around for survival. They could actually pursue education as a dedicated endeavor. The other piece was you needed language. If you're communicating in Krantz, you can't communicate sophisticated. It's simply not possible. And then when you develop language, and think about your own kids, how much can you convey directly depends on the sophistication of that language, not just the sophistication of the person or the intelligence of the person that's using that language. If I'm limited to small, basic words, we realize there's only so much I can communicate. If I want to talk about computing concepts, I need language to be evolved enough so that I can introduce those concepts and have words to do so, or introduce enough content in the language to introduce new words and define them in the existing language. So we had education, we know we did, but the language and agriculture were both sophisticated and developed enough so that we could actually communicate the concepts that were discovered. But that's not enough to propagate. You had to make it more formal, right? Shastra itself, and if you look at Vedanta, the term Veda Anta, what you had was an organization of knowledge that came out of debate and was agreed upon at the end of it. Now, for that, you need organization and you need the ability to debate. But if you look at the ability to debate and look at how do you get that ability, you need two other things. You need a formal language and you need a knowledge system that supports that formal language. How many times have you talked and debated with someone and 30 minutes, an hour, 2 hours later, you realize you were talking right past each other? And that the reason that happens is you're not using a formal language. You may both be using the same language, may both be English or Hindi or Malayali or whatever the language may be. It's the same language, but you're using it as we speak it in common tongue. When you go into academic debates, where you go into PhD thesis defense, for example, in those things, there's a very formal language that's used where words, meanings can't be interchanged. That's the type of formal language you need. From a knowledge system perspective, you need to be very specific to use that formal language in the context of the debate you're having. So therefore, your education has to have evolved enough and your content has to have evolved enough such that you can develop this knowledge system itself. When you have those two things, you are now in a position to have an organization and a debate. And you need to have enough of these over a prolonged period of time and space for something to become formal and formally accepted and broadly accepted. If it's a debate that's one-off in a certain part of the world and no one else hears about it, does it matter? Was that knowledge passed on anywhere? Did anyone else learn it or learn the conclusion of the debate? The answer is no. So then did you actually develop and propagate that language? And the answer, that knowledge? And the answer is no. Now, all of this happened in prehistory. What happened in ancient times? So now we're talking about old and long time ago, but not forgotten. And what we have proof of is writing. And say, okay, we have writing, but what does that mean? What else did you need to have that writing? You needed a language to write in. You needed script. You needed materials to write on. So you had to have enough sciences to develop the material that you could write on in the first place, not to mention the ink and the pen. If you're carving everything into wood, then that's a very different thing in terms of level of effort to write something and to store it, versus something like palm leaf or paper. You also had to understand and value the benefits of writing as well as the limitations of writing. And you see that in Shastra, that there is a benefit and value to writing, but there's a recognition of the limits of writing as well. And in ancient times, and we have evidence of this, which is why it's an ancient and not prehistory, is we have tens of thousands of transcripts that are in palm leaf that have been preserved for thousands of years. Many of them, unfortunately, are disintegrating, but many of them have existed and been reproduced over time. As things evolved and time passed, you needed to consolidate those materials. And for consolidation to be successful, you needed a civilization to evolve that would do that consolidation. So you had the knowledge system, you had the writing capabilities, you had the debate, you understood the value of all those things, and then your civilization evolved to something more sophisticated and broader. And there is a need to bring these things together, or recognition there is value to bring these things together. But they couldn't have happened in absence of civilization, because just the infrastructure required to support such an endeavor wouldn't have existed. And then you needed time and further development. Everything to here needed a tremendous amount of time, but then there's a continual amount of time and development that happens. And you need time, and in tens of years, hundreds of years, thousands of years, for this body of work to grow on itself. Of course, with history, we had war. Now, war needs weapons that are developed to a point where you can have war. Unfortunately, that also means when you have war, you have destruction of knowledge. And so you lose some. Not only due to war, but you can lose distraught knowledge by natural disaster, by breakdown in the ethos and the belief of value of education, or belief that someone else's education, someone else's knowledge is not worth preserving. So those are ethos breakdowns. Either way, we know there was tremendous destruction of knowledge in our history. And then with time, there's rediscovery and recompilation, which needs a desire to preserve and to grow. If we look at Vyasadeva and the Vedas as we receive them today, it's clear that there was recompilation. The Vedas did not exist in that shape and form prior to Vyasadeva putting them in that shape and form. We know that because he says it. But it's not just about recompilation. There's rediscovery, an ongoing discovery of concepts that were hinted at in sutras or elaborated at, or further development of it. So we had Shastra. We developed all the subsidiary things to support it. We developed it. We lost it. We redeveloped it, we simplified it, we compiled it, because we understood the value as a civilization of that thing. When you take all of this into account, and it's hard to put a timeline, but we can say some things were certain years old, some things were here, some things happened here. But what do we have today? Turns out we have quite a bit. You have the Vedas, the Rig, the Yajur, the Sam, the Atharva. Each of them are broken into certain parts. So there's Samhitas, there's Brahmanas, there's Aranyakas, there's Upanishads. And when you look at them, each of the Vedas have a Samhita portion. So there's four of them. They have a Brahmana portion. Each of them has roughly 12. So 12 times 4 is 48. You have the Aranyakas. You have roughly 12 of those as well, times 4. So again, 48. In Upanishads, roughly 200 in each of those Vedas, so roughly 800 of them. But that wasn't all. Those are the things that apurushe. They're not originating from the human mind. Human mind acted as a propagator of them. We also had the smritis that did come from the human mind. Those were broadly categorized into Upavedas, Vedangas, Agamas, Upangas, Darshanas. Each of those had subcategories. So Upaveda included things like Dhanurveda, Ayurveda, Gandharvaveda, Arthashastra. The Vedangas include things like Vyakarana, Siksha, Nirukta, Chanda. You can read through this, this list. I won't read through all of it, but this is a lot. And fortunately or unfortunately, this is not a complete list. It's an entirely incomplete list, because a complete list simply couldn't fit on a slide. Or a set of slides. The other piece to recognize is this represents a structure of knowledge, not the age of the documented knowledge. These names also represent the most recent recompilation, which is a thing we got. We also know that the types of knowledge and the category of knowledge is intermingled. The categorization here is very different from the way we categorize knowledge today. And so when we go to document and we say the Rig Veda is the oldest Veda, what does that actually mean? the Rig Veda, as it stands today, is the result of a recompilation of Vyasadeva. And there are events, say, in the Yajur Veda or the Tharva Veda that are discussed that are actually older than events in the Rig Veda. And there are events in the Rig Veda that may be more recent than some in the Yajur Veda. So what does it mean when we say the Rig Veda is the oldest Shastra, the oldest text? It means it may be the oldest of the most recent compilation. Well, what does that mean? How much time did it take to recompile that it happened to have come in first, but the others came in quick succession? And then we also know, and I've said this a couple of times, it has been around for a while in other forms, in other compilations. And so the knowledge contained within the Rig Veda has a different age and a date than the Veda itself as a text that was compiled. And I'm not talking about text as a book, but text as in the set of content in that shape and form, however it was communicated, oral or written. Let me pause here for a second. I've been going through a couple of slides. Are there any questions at this point? Or should we keep going?
I think it's better to keep going, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry, go ahead, Auntie.
No.
Okay. The other thing to remember is when we talk about ideas and we talk about perspective, you can have an idea-centric discussion or an event-centric discussion. And you can have an event-centric discussion versus a person-centric discussion. And when we come from one perspective and the materials in front of us come from a different perspective, then it may be hard to map. And we may say, does that make sense or does that not make sense? And you have to understand the perspective of the authorship of the materials you're studying if you have any hope of understanding them. Otherwise, you simply cannot. Many times when you'll go into discussion, you'll talk about this in the sense of Shastra is subjective versus science is objective. And we treat it, we discuss it as if the subjective is less important than the objective. But is it really? Subjective is not undefinable, and it's not fully variable if you treat it like a science. It just happens that modern science treats things objectively and therefore excludes an entire topic from discussion. And then there are elements of science that cannot do that. And they say the objective is actually directly relational to the subjective. In science, you get confused, say, well, does that mean subjective is more important or less important? And then if you go that deep, read examples from science, think about Schrodinger's equation, and specifically Schrodinger's cat. A cat is in a box that you have no idea what the state of the cat is. Is the cat alive or dead? But we won't know until you observe it by opening the box. So the answer is it's both. Subjective directly influences the objective truth. When you look at Shastra, it says the subjective is important as the objective. And so it has a very different perception of a perspective of the world than what we treat today. The other piece when you look at Shastra is to recognize that they are not historical texts. They're knowledge texts that happen to have history. And we use that history to define the age of it and attribute importance but based on the age. But the authors never treated the historical aspect of what they were doing as the thing that was important or worth preserving. They felt that the knowledge itself was the thing that was worth preserving, and it was sufficient to preserve it. It had to be communicated, it had to be taught, and it had to be further developed. And you see that when you open many of these texts, there's a dialogue between a teacher and a student. And the one thing that every text has in common in these dialogues is a student has to ask questions and the teacher gives the answers to questions. And so as a seeker, now you have to go find the text with the student that has the same question as you do to get an answer from a text, or you need someone to interpret and extrapolate to take your question and apply that knowledge to give you your answer. Usually those are the gurus and the sannyasins, or the sannyasis, who have spent the time to study the breadth of the shastra. And even then, most of them can't have studied everything because this topic materials are just too large. So that is about setting context behind shastra, what it is, what's its breadth. But where do we begin our journey? Because this discussion is a journey through shastra. And so we have to begin with the Veda. That's the apurushay piece. That's the piece that was not originated in the brains of men. We were rather the conduit of this knowledge. And so at this point forward, we're going to give examples that you may or may not have thought of and talk about them in the context of shastra, but also in modern terminology. So in the Veda, there is a discussion of a ratha. Now, when we think of a rat or a ratha, what we think about is the Mahabharata and the type of rats that's depicted in B.R. Chopra's Mahabharata for many of us, but pick any one that you'd like. Typically, two-wheeled, sometimes four-wheeled, a set of horses dragging it. There's a charioteer and a warrior. Sometimes there's not even a charioteer. This is the way we think about a ratha. Is this the thing that's described in the Rig Veda? Would you think of this as a ratha? The Vidyut Ratha is something that's explicitly described in the Rig Veda as a powered vehicle. What about this? The Tri Chakra Ratha is discussed in the Rig Veda as a three-wheeled flying vehicle. And these are translations, but they are literal translations of the things in the text itself. If we go to the next one, the Kara Ratha is an amphibious vehicle. Many of us haven't even run into these, unless you happen to live in Seattle or Boston, then you can actually take a duck tour and you get to sit in one of these. These are very popularly used in World War II as well. But these are discussed in the Rig Veda, and there are three examples. We can talk about the Tritala Ratha, the Vidyut Ratha, the Jalayan. There's so many more. But the point is, we have a presumption about a level of technology that existed in Shastra versus opening the Shastra and seeing what is actually described, and then seeing, can we understand it? Have we advanced ourselves to a level where we have the equipment, the technology, and the language to understand the thing that's being communicated? When we think about the model of the solar system, this came about a couple hundred years ago, and someone had to die to make a point in ancient Greece. But the Rig Veda and the Aitreya Brahmana says the sun does never set nor rise. When people think the sun is setting, it is not so. After having arrived at the end of the day, it makes itself produce two opposite, making night to what is below and day to what is on the other side. Elsewhere in the Rig Veda, it says the sun has tied earth and other planets through attraction and moves them around itself as if a trainer moves newly trained horses around itself holding their reins. Elsewhere, it talks about the earth as devoid of hands and legs, yet it moves ahead. All the objects over the earth also move with it. It moves around the sun. Think about your studies and your examples of shastra. How many times have you pictured the sun as Bhagwan Suryadev in a chariot with horses going through the sky? Or the personification of earth as Bhumi Devi, moving, pleading for help with Bhagwan Vishnu. At the same time, you have these descriptions in the Rig Veda. How do you reconcile these? Clearly, when you look at this, you say, well, that's the heliocentric solar system. There's no other option as a student of science for me to understand this any other way. My next question would be, are you sure this is in the Rig Veda? Did you make this up? Or did you interpret it to mean this way? And the answer is no. I didn't do the interpretation. Someone else did. And they weren't a student of science when they did it. And you, in fact, you can look this up in any Rig Veda translation and you'll come to the same conclusion. Now the challenge becomes, well, what's the dating of the Rig Veda? Then is this an extrapolation or interpolation? Meaning someone added this later on. But when could they have added it? Since that person died in Greece a couple hundred years ago? Well, that's an easy answer. Well, it turns out that Rig Veda has two recensions. Two. And what's a recension? It's a variation of the text itself. And so it doesn't matter where in India you go, where this knowledge is still preserved, when you pick up the Rig Veda, you're getting one of the two. There is no third in authoritative lineage of the Rig Veda. And if both of them have it, then you can be pretty assured that this wasn't introduced in the last 400 years. Could it have been before? Who knows? But the point is, it wasn't added after Western Europe discovered and agreed to these facts. So you say, okay, what does this mean about the sense of knowledge of the people that described this? And they don't attribute authorship to themselves. They say, I am but a pipe. At the same time, you know this knowledge landed outside of that pipe at a certain period of time in history. Now, when we talk about history, and we're going to take some examples from the Rig Veda and the Yajur Veda. The Rig Veda talks about equinox being in Ashwini, the Devati being at the winter solstice, the vernal equinox being in Punarvasu, and a vernal equinox in Mriga, Shira. These are four astronomical events that are being discussed, right? And they relate to certain times and events on Earth being in a certain time relative to the constellations. Rather than going to the specifics of what each of these events time and space, rather it's were. What's more important is to say, well, when did they happen last? Turns out the last time the winter equinox was in Ashwini was in 7000 BC. The Devati being at the solar winter solstice was in 6000 BC. And the most recent event was the vernal equinox in Mrigashira BC. So just between these four events, we span 2,000 years, which happened in 5,000. Now we say, well, Yajurveda came after the Rig Veda. That's common knowledge. Yajurveda talks about Purva Bhadrapada Nakshatra as rising in the due east. The last time that happened was in 10,000 BC. And Kritika being at the winter solstice, which happened in 8,500 BC. Wait, what? We just said the Rig Veda was the oldest and Yajurveda came later. That's common knowledge. Then how does it have events that predate the Rig Veda if its authorship can be attributed to later than the Rig Veda? Well, there's only two ways. Either you believe the knowledge came through that pipe afterwards and described events that came later, earlier, the knowledge that came prior to it that landed in the Rig Veda. Okay, if we have to assume that, then you have to assume the pipe existed. That causes a challenge because either you believe in the pipe or you don't, and most people simply don't. So you say, well, that challenges certain presuppositions there. Or the Yajurveda could have come before the Rig Veda. Well, that's a challenge because everyone who's been busy dating the Rig Veda says it's the oldest. So is all of that science gobbledygook and wrong? The only other possibility is you believe the argument that I started with about recompilation and rediscovery. You say the contents of the Rig Veda and Yajurveda were known to man prior to Vyasadev. Compilation, he mixed them up and he may have produced the Rig Veda first and the Yajurveda later. That's the only way this knowledge, which was known and in his prior to his authorship, got put in this order. Well, that's great, but now you also have to presume that these Vedas existed prior to Vyasadeva in a different form. That is also troubling to modern science and modern history, because they'd like to attribute a date, and we're saying you can't use the construction of the text to date the text. All right, how many of you are students of science and genetics? On the left, from the Rig Veda, the ingenious Ribhu brothers prepared a chariot for Indra. They prepared two powerful horses, the the second being cloned from the first. The Ribu brothers produced a cow which yielded copious milk. During the experiment, Ribu said, we can make two cells from the original one. Vajra said, we can make three, because he observed that when one cell was divided into two, there were three cells. Vibhu observed and said, we can make four, as a second cell can be divided equally like the first. This is typically, we don't talk about genetics being a traditional subject, and we don't think about this level of biological knowledge and genetic knowledge from coming from the Rig Veda. But how do we get these examples in this level of detail? And remember, the Vedas were not about science either. Just like they weren't a historical text, they were about preserving and propagating knowledge. So how did we end up with this? If we skip to another topic in the Rig Veda, if you're a computer scientist, forward error correcting codes. It's a technique used to control errors in data transmission over noisy communication protocols. It's a technique that's used to communicate the thing I'm speaking into this microphone through my laptop, through an unknown number of servers, to the system that's hosting this talk, through that into the telephone system, network we're using where we're doing audio only, and the audio video over the internet, through a huge number of servers and network links before it lands to each of you individually. Or if you're using a cell phone, when you talk to each other over a cell phone. The way this is done is the one who's sending that message, not you as the speaker, but the system that's doing the encoding, in other words, your phone, the laptop behind this microphone, it's encoding the message in a way that it adds extra data. And that extra data is sufficient to recreate this message if certain amounts of data is not has not arrived accurately at the destination. That extra data is also used to determine whether the original data was not arrived correctly and there is an error. That extra data is called an error correcting code, ECC for short. The first error correcting code that we think about was produced by Richard Hamming in 1950. Yet, the Vedas provide details of 11 that I've found that have varying degree of complexity and redundant data. But it's aimed very much at preserving words and ordering the pronunciation and vocal, using ordering, pronunciation, and vocal inflections. The names of these 11 include things like Samhita, Pada, Krama, Jata, Mala, Shikha, Rekha, Dvaja, Danda, Ratha, and Gana. If you look at Kana, and specifically Kana part as the full form, the algorithm that it uses is described here, where you say word one, word two, then reverse the order, word two, word one. Then you go word one, word two, word three, then reverse the order, three, two, one, so on and so forth. So if we listen to the Gayatri Mantra, and Auntie, can you confirm that folks can hear this?
Yes.
Can you hear that? Okay, perfect. So then let me play this.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so everyone on the call probably recognizes that as the Gayatri Mantra, correct?
Yes.
Now, do you recognize this?
Yes.
Savitur Vareyam Bhargo Bhargo Sirimani. Dio yo yo dio dio yo lo no yo dio dio yo la yo no no yo yo la presodayat Om Janaha, Om Tamaha, Om Satyam, Om Tatsavidurvare, Yam Bharko Devasya Dhimahi, Diyo Yona Prachodayat, Oma Bojo Dhira Sombritam Brahma Purgu Vasuvaro.
How many of you recognize that as the Gayatri Mantra?
Yes.
Yes, we do.
Right? So if you listen to it carefully and you put this algorithm in place, what does it tell you? If you lose any word in Ghanapart, you will not only be able to detect that you lost a word, but also that if it was wrong and what the correction should be. And so remember I said over, the Rig Veda has two recensions. There are only two variations of the Rig Veda. The reason we are certain, but we can't play a game of telephone and make sure in a room of 10 people that the last person has the same thing as the first person, is because the presence of a parallel tradition with error correcting codes. These 11 and the others that come to us through Shastra are the only examples in the world and world history of error correction codes being used through an oral tradition. And yet we think error correction codes were invented in 1950. So stepping away from the Vedas, we're now going to look into the Upaveda. So this piece, I think most folks will recognize that dance, drama, and music come to us through the Gandharva Veda. In fact, it's not just dance comes through the Veda. The system of dance, the knowledge of the dance, the description of the postures, the mudras, the eye motions, the meanings of the different forms are all there. Similarly, it's not just their stories of drama in the Gandharva Ved, but it describes the systems, the techniques, the meanings of dance. Same thing when it comes to music. So the performing arts were systemized and communicated in a way with an aim to educate. Before we go on to Vedanga, any questions at this point?
No, everything perfect.
Okay. So this next text section gets a little bit complicated. But I mentioned certain things with regards to things happening in the stars. And we're going to take and talk about a couple of them. The tropical year is the time it takes for the Earth to move between two equinoxes. It's also called the solar year. The solar year is it takes for Earth to go 365 degrees around the Sun. The reason the two are different is because you have to remember that the Sun itself is also moving and also rotating. So the equinox here, we went from our starting point to the ending point, but because the Sun was moving, we didn't end up where we started. In fact, we can never end up where we start the way the stars move and the way the Earth is moving. And when we look at science and what we know is that the tropical year changes every year, right? By 0.0053 degrees, in fact. And so the precession is 50.26 minutes per year. Now, Surya Siddhanta, which minimally is dated 2,000 years, declares that the tropical year, the interval between the two equinoxes, is 365.2435374 days. Somewhat of an arbitrary precision. There must have been a reason for that precision that was given. But in the year 2000, modern science calculated it to be 365.2421897 days. So the difference is in the third digit decimal, the thousandths place, is the largest difference between the two. Now the challenge is, the difference between the two, if we subtract them, is 1:54.44128 seconds. That's the difference in our calculation in the year 2000 from the Surya Siddhanta. To make matters more complicated, we're in the year 2020. And so the valley in 2000 that I've written here is not the same as it is today. Further, that dip back to the time of Surya Siddhanta, and if we had modern inference, would have changed the science, we would have gotten a different value. Because remember, the period itself changes every year. So now we say, well, Surya Siddhanta is inaccurate. Okay, great, it's not accurate. How inaccurate is it? According to modern standard, it's actually really, really close, right? One, less than 2 minutes apart from today. But who's bothered to say, well, were they accurate for their time? And what was the accuracy in their time for the tropical year? Well, turns out we don't have the science to do that. We can extrapolate back saying, well, it exchanges by this much per year, so let's do that math backwards and say, well, how did it land? But the challenge is there are things with very large periods of time that interact and can cause the sun to change. So now you have to calculate, well, what are the changes in the sun and its orbital period over that period of time? Are there other things that could have impacted the Earth's tropical year over this long period of time that could have also caused it to change? And we just don't know. What we do know is, regardless of trying to get to accurate, was it was really, really close to what we calculated to be 20 years ago. And even if we calculate today, it would be really, really close. Turns out, it's not easy to calculate this thing, even today. But if we had to calculate it back then, what does that mean? And what happens if they were 100% accurate, assuming we're 100% accurate today? Well, if we say their date was 100% accurate, and it was accurate for their time when they calculated it, that would mean the Surya Siddhanta was authored something like 21,592 years ago, or 19,592 BCE. And you're going to say, Krishna, but wait, you just told me it was authored 2,000 years ago. How can that be? And therein lies the conundrum, because modern science dates Surya Siddhanta to be authored around 2,000 years ago. One of the two has to give. And if it's not 21,000 years, then you have to say there was some level of error. And so, okay, what was that error? And we can't calculate it. So now it comes to, what do you choose to believe about this text? The other piece is, what does it take to calculate something to this level of precision? Remember, like when we started this conversation, we talked about, here's a specific development that was required for Shastra. And here's the presumptions of technology or evolutions of civilization that had to have happened for this development to have happened. Well, turns out, if you look at the night sky with your thumb, right, with the naked eye, not even glasses, you can distinguish 6 degrees. So anything that moves more than 6 degrees, you will think has moved. Anything that has moved less than 6 degrees, you can't distinguish that motion from night to night, and you'll never know. So, okay, well, presume that they didn't have any equipment. Great, how long would a naked eye observation have to happen every day, night after night, to get to this level of precision? Turns out that calculation is something we can do, but we don't like the number. It's about 10,000 years. Okay, well, what does that mean? What do you need to do that? Well, you need a lot of people with a lot of free time in a society that can afford to pay someone to look at the night sky night after night, generation after generation, for thousands of years. That has to assume a certain amount of surplus generation in society to sponsor that level of academic endeavor. Okay, that's hard to believe that long ago. What else? They could use telescopes and other observational equipment. Does that sound more pliable, more reasonable? But then the question is, well, what equipment did they use? And how much time did it take to develop that equipment? Maybe. Wait, Krishna, you said telescope. So how long does it take to build a telescope? Turns out at least 1,000 years, if not more. We see that in modern So this text, which we say is 2,000 years ago, now suddenly needs 1,000 years of development to get there. Do we want to give them credit for that? Answer is no, not really, we don't. Well, okay, then you say, traditional Hindu dharma says, someone sat in meditation and received this knowledge. That's great, but that means now you have to give credence to the fact that they could receive this knowledge through meditation. That means you've now affirmed everything in Hindu dharma. Do you want to do that? Turns out not many people want to do that either. So the answer, no matter which way, is something we don't want to stomach as a society, as a modern society. But you have to give credit for one of these three. Because the fact is, Surya Siddhanta gave an answer to the tropical year that was less than 2 minutes apart from today. And no one else in civilization hasn't been able to do anything similar. Even a couple hundred years ago, the answer is widely different from modern science. To make life more difficult for modern humanists and modern civilization, this isn't the only example about astronomy from Shastra. This is one example I pulled out. We're going to switch topics again to Agama. And Agama talked about Archa worship and Pratima worship as two very different things. If we talk about Archa worship, consecration here transforms an inanimate object into a deity. Then it causes Bhagwan, God, to descend into the object. The purpose of the deity here and the consecration is to create a purpose of daily worship. But the devotee feels the presence of Bhagwan in the deity. Deity becomes an object of love. What does that mean? I'm going to take this toy dinosaur from my son. Can you guys all see this?
Yep.
No. Okay, if I take this and I have the right pundit with the right knowledge, he can use this and make this an object of worship. Because as part of the puja, he can ask Bhagwan to come and imbibe this object. So say, Krishna Bhagwan, please come and reside in this object for the purpose of my worship. And then this will go in my altar and I will worship it every day. And I sit in front of it and I feel Bhagwan is in my presence. Am I right or wrong to do this? Turns out, according to Shastra, I'm absolutely okay to do it. The object itself is meaningless. The act of consecration itself is the important thing. And the bhavana that I have towards Bhagwan in this swaroop is the important thing, not the thing itself. The act of consecration made this toy that's lying on my desk waiting for its battery to be charged as a thing that's worthy of devotional service. Now, if we look at Pratima worship, here, and I'm going to take a different example from my desk, and I'm going to take this pen. This can become a symbol to enable me to focus on Bhagawan. Right? And so if I use this as a way to get Bhagwan established in my mind, then the purpose of the symbol is lost in the sense that it doesn't matter. So you take it away or you destroy it because I used it to get Bhagwan up here and that's the only thing that was important. Right? And so now I have Bhagwan here and I can picture him in my mind's eye and do that worship that way. So this is now a tool. So the difference between these two, this stays in front of me and helps me feel Bhagwan's presence. This is used to feel Bhagwan's presence inside me. So let me ask a question, which is, do we worship idols? Can we have someone give an answer so we can move on?
We worship deities, yes.
So I didn't ask if we worship deities. I asked if we worshiped idols.
Murti.
The question leads to the answer. So essentially, we worship deities, not idols.
That's correct. However, when you look at talks from many people greater than me, in Hindu dharma, they talk about idols. They don't talk about deities. And it is a tactic for missionaries to talk about Hindu worship of idols and that being sacrilege in their eyes. And they denounce us for it. And so here, language becomes really important. And I'm intentionally using language that is wrong in my slide, but correcting it when I'm talking. I'm not sure if you're picking up on it. My slide said consecration causes God to descend into the object. The word here you have to be careful of is the word God. Right? Just like we're picking apart deity versus idol, recognize the language we're using has limitations and it has connotations. The English language is a Judeo-Christian construct. And so God in the English language has a Judeo-Christian connotation. If you heard me talking, I consciously juxtaposed God with Bhagawan when I was talking. Bhagawan does not have the same connotation as God. But when our saints and our gurus and our sannyasins come and talk, they typically have a very deep understanding of Shastra. They may not have a similarly deep understanding of English. In fact, I would argue most of them do not. And so when you hear these words, it can cause confusion. They're using the word idol in the sense of deity, but their English is somehow limited to the fact that idol comes out of their mouth. Doesn't make the concepts that they're communicating any less. And there's usually enough context with a Hindu audience that they inherently understand. But in this country, when we're communicating with others, it's incredibly important that we use the correct terminology. And in many cases, if you can't figure it out, use the terminology from an Indic language, because the context is there. And if someone can't understand it, they will just understand it to be something they get that can't be translated into English. Or if they say, oh, you mean God, you say something like that, but Bhagawan means more, and you can leave it at that. You don't have to go into a dictionary definition in every discussion. But language is important, and this is the reason we talk about objects of worship, because they can be counterintuitive. We'll go into upangas. So I'm assuming many of the women on this call have had kids. And I'm hoping there are not a whole lot of kids in this call as well that are very young. But if we talk, there is a discussion of embryology in the Srimad Bhagavatam. And explicitly it talks about, on the first night, the sperm and the ovum mix. And on the fifth night, the mixture ferments into a bubble. On the tenth night, it develops into a form like a plum. And after that, it gradually turns into a lump of flesh or an egg. In the course of a month, a head is formed, and at the end of 2 months, the hands, the feet, and the other limbs take shape. By the end of 3 months, the nails, the fingers, the toes, the body hair, the bones, the skin appear, as do the organs of generation and the other apertures in the body, namely the eyes, nostrils, ears, mouth, and anus. Within 4 months from the date of conception, the seven essential ingredients of the body, namely chyle, blood, flesh, fat, bone, marrow, and semen, come into existence. At the end of 5 months, hunger and thirst make themselves felt. At the end of 5 months, hunger, thirst make themselves felt, and at the end of 6 months, the fetus enclosed by the amnion begins to move on the right side of the abdomen. Wait, what? This is in Srimad Bhagavatam, and you can pick your translation. In fact, I made it a point to read Srimad Bhagavatam with my kids at night. And I distinctly remember my wife was pregnant with her third child, and I was going through Srimad Bhagavatam with my older two. The oldest at that time would have been roughly five. And he heard this, and then he went to ask my wife, his mom, of, Mummy, you said that the fetus is moving, that the baby is moving, sorry. Did he move to the left or the right? She said, right. He's like, he's going to be a boy. I forget the specifics, but I'm recalling. And we had the ultrasound soon thereafter and confirmed his prediction. He's like, of course Shastra is right, and Shastra said this in Bhagavatam, therefore, of course it had to be right. How can there be any doubt? In a lot of ways, it's better to listen to Shastra as a child because you take it without question. And you take it as it says it, versus the rest of us as we grow older. We tend to doubt ourselves, and we tend to doubt our Shastra about it being right or wrong. Regardless, to develop this level of knowledge about the womb and about the shape of a fetus in the course of development is non-trivial. Right? If we take, and this is the reason I asked and hope that there are not a lot of kids on the call, is there's only a couple ways to do it. In modern science, we have ultrasounds. In old times, you can assume this appeared, so through meditation. But the grotesque approach of this is cadaver-based research, in which case hundreds, if not thousands, of women cadavers had to be dissected during the course of pregnancy, where they happened to have hopefully died in the course of their pregnancy through natural causes. The dissection had to happen. The ovum had to be studied in its development. And it has to be thousands, because one or two won't give you this level of detail, or even more, that Bhagavatam goes into, to understand the development of the baby over that period of time. Those babies aren't normally born at any of those stages, so it's not like they can be observed naturally. What do you want to assume? If you want to assume meditation, great, then you have to affirm that it's possible through meditation, that that pipeline exists. If you don't, then you have to assume that the grotesque. And if you do, again, if someone is doing that level of research, that means they have time to waste on that level of research. And they have to have the presence of cadavers for that level of research. And since that many people don't die in one place and in any concentrated period of time, you need a system of transportation. And you need a system of communication that people know they have to transport those cadavers here instead of burning them at the carts. You have to assume there's a system to sustain that level of research so that they can do this quote-unquote non-productive thing instead of doing agriculture and feeding everyone else, as the majority of society is busy doing. So there has to be a certain amount of excess. So as you go into those preconditions to allow this level of research to happen, you end up creating a timeline of civilization to justify this research even being possible in the first place. At the end of it, though, this is something any of you, I'm assuming most folks on this call, will have a Bhagavatam set. So you can, of everything in this presentation, this is probably the easiest for you to confirm. Flip open Srimad Bhagavatam, third book, chapter 31, stanzas 3 and 4. So you can flip this open and confirm it on your own that this is actually there. It certainly was there in the translation from Gita Press that we have and we use at home. This translation specifically isn't there, but the words may be different, but the concepts are all the same. You can't talk about Shastra without talking about Gita. And so specifically, I have an excerpt here about the Atma and the nature of it. Just as the Atma acquires a childhood body, a youth body, and an old age body during this life, similarly, Atma acquires another body after death. No one can destroy the indestructible Atma. Neither can it be slayed, nor is it slain, neither can it slay, nor is it slain. It's permanent and primeval. Just as a person puts on new garments after discarding the old ones, similarly, Atma acquires new bodies after casting away the old ones. Weapons do not cut it, fire does not burn it, and water does not wet it. It's unmanifest, unthinkable and unchanging. Some describe it as a wonder, others describe it as wonderful. Others yet hear of it as a wonder. Even after hearing about it, no one actually knows it. This is one description of Atma. You can hear thousands of different descriptions of Atma across the different shastras and across the different gurus, but the message is consistent. This is the thing we tend to focus on the most. It's the philosophical. It's about the nature of reality. It's not the things that we've been talking about, which we don't talk about. So I'm not going to belabor this one. I'm assuming this is familiar to most of the folks on this call. Here is another example, and I talked about weapons being a traditional subject. This is about the Agnya Astra. And I'm going to read a section from Mahabharata. This is the salient points on the screen. The translation of Mahabharata into English that this is from was written by Kishori Mohan Ganguly, who died in 1895. And the work itself was published between 1883 and 1896. The reason that's important will become self-evident. The valiant Ashwatthama, when staying resolutely on his car, touched water and invoked the Agnaya weapon, incapable of being resisted by the very gods. Aiming at all his visible and invisible foes, the preceptor's son, that slayer of hostile heroes, inspired with mantras a blazing shaft possessed of the effulgence of a smokeless fire, and lit it off on all sides, filled with rage. Dense showers of arrows then issued from it in the welkin. Endued with fiery flames, these arrows encompassed Bhartha on all sides. Meteors flashed down from the firmament. A thick gloom suddenly shrouded the Pandava host. All the points of the compass were also enveloped by that darkness. Rakshas, Pisachas, crowding together, uttered fierce cries. Inauspicious winds began to blow. Sun himself no longer gave any heat. Ravens fiercely croaked on all sides. Clouds roared in the welkin, showering blood. Birds and beasts and kine, and the munis of high vows, and souls under complete control became exceedingly uneasy. The very elements seemed to be perturbed. The sun seemed to turn. The universe scorched with heat, seemed to be in fever. The elephants and other creatures of the land, scorched by the energy of that weapon, ran in fright, breathing heavily, and desirous of protection against that terrible force. The very waters heated, the creatures residing in that element. Obhart became exceedingly uneasy and seemed to burn. From all the points of the compass, cardinal and subsidiary, from the firmament and the very earth, showers of sharp and fierce arrows fell and issued from the impetuosity of Garuda, or the wind. Struck and burnt by those shafts of Ashwatthama that were all endued with the impetuosity of the thunder, the hostile warriors fell down like trees burnt down by a raging fire. Huge elephants, burnt by that weapon, fell down on the earth all around, uttering fierce cries loud as the rumblings of the clouds. Other huge elephants, scorched by that fire, ran hither and thither and roared aloud in fear, as if in the midst of a forest conflagration. The steeds, O king, and the cars also, burnt by that weapon, looked, O sire, like the tops of trees burnt in a forest fire. Thousands of cars fell down on the energy of all sides. Indeed, O Bharat, it seemed that the divine Lord Agni burnt the Pandava host in that battle, like the Samvarta fire consuming everything at the end of the yoga. Then Arjun, O king, invoked into existence the Brahma weapon, capable of baffling every other weapon, as ordained by the lotus-born Brahma himself. Within a moment, that darkness was dispelled, cool winds began to blow, and all the points of the compass became clear and bright. We then beheld a wonderful sight. A full Akshahoni of the Pandava troops laid low, burnt by the energy of Ashwatthama's weapon. The forms of the slain could not be distinguished. Then those two heroic and mighty bowmen, Keshava and Arjun, freed from that darkness, were seen together like the sun and the moon in the firmament. Indeed, the wielder of Gandhiv and Kesha were both unwounded. Equipped with its banners and standards and steeds, with the Anukasha unjoined, and with all the mighty weapons stored on it, remaining uninjured, that car, so terrible to thy warriors, freed from that darkness, shone resplendent on the field. So one Akshahoni here means 218,700 Pandava troops were killed. Does anyone know how many people were killed by one of the two nuclear weapons that were fired in Japan? If I remember correctly, something on the order of magnitude of 16,000 or 20,000. Now, when we look at description, sorry, was there a comment?
No.
If I look at the words here and call a few of them out, darkness and inauspicious winds began to blow. The sun no longer gave any heat. Does that mean the sun literally didn't give any heat? Or the explosion of the weapon was so strong and the heat it gave was so strong that relative to it, the sun no longer gave any heat? It felt cool to the touch. Similarly, when we talk about the universe scorched with heat and was in fever, water boiled, creatures burned, warriors felt like trees burnt down by a ravaging fire. Any normal weapon does not do that, and any weapon born of archery certainly does not boil any weapon, any water, and certainly does not burn anything like a treetop burned by a fire. Right? So this meant this had to be some form of chemical or nuclear reaction. There is no other choice. Now, if we talk about huge elephants being burned by that weapon, well, it takes a lot to kill an elephant, it turns out. That's the reason they were considered the battle tanks of the ancient world. You couldn't kill an arrow. You could make it angry or hurt it and cause it to go wild by kill it easily within a shooting it in the eyes or in some sensitive portion of its body. But you couldn't kill it that way. You needed very large weapons to bring down an elephant, or a very large number, not one. Similarly, the cars and steeds burned down. Sorry, hold on one second. Hari beta, thodi der baad mein, Arju, aap hai. So if we look at this and look at the effects, right, they're disastrous enough a weapon that we claim to have but have never tested. Right? We claim to have weapons that could do this today in the nuclear age, and they're nuclear in nature. The only thing else that came was a weapon that was used in Germany, I'm forgetting the time, was based on, I believe it was used in Dresden, that had similar effects. But that fire that killed that large number of people really killed them by asphyxiation. The fire took all the oxygen out of the sky, and so people died not because of the weapon directly, not because of its fire, but because there was no oxygen to breathe, and so they died of lack of oxygen. Here, that's not the case. So is it a massive weapon? Europe, and who knows, but it's like it. What else is clear is there was something to clean up the after effects, right? We end with, they came out, Arjun fired the Brahma weapon, and it took all of these after effects away. The other piece is, there is a vehicle in the midst of all of this, a special vehicle, sure, but it withstood the effect at point blank range. Ashwatthama wasn't firing in any random direction, and Arjun and Krishna happened to be in the circumference. He was firing at them. And they walked out. That means there were vehicles that were capable of taking a weapon like this head on and coming out uninjured. Most people didn't have such a vehicle, but such a vehicle existed. And they happened to have it. So you had a weapon that looks a hell of a lot like a nuclear weapon. You have something that can clean up the radiation that it causes. And you have a vehicle that can withstand it at point blank range. Think about the technology and the development of civilization, the development of knowledge required to do all three of those things. We have one of those three, not three of those three today. Skipping forward to darshanas. So whenever you talk about darshanas, you have to talk about pramana, or the source of knowledge. And these are the pramanas that I could find that are discussed. Pratyaksha, Anumana, Upamana, Itihasam, Ardhapati, Anupalabdi, Shabda, Aithyam, Abhavam, Cheshta, and Yukti. All the different darshanas do not use all of these, and this is not a complete list. But if we go through and look at some of these, Pratyaksha is direct perception. I see that your hair is black, therefore it is black. Anumanam is inference. Where there's smoke, there's fire. So if there I see smoke, I'm going to assume there's a fire behind it. Upamanam is analogy. A wild ox is assumed to be in the bovine family, as it has the same root. Gao, in this case. Itihasam is historical fact. Whether you take it as Ramayana or Mahabharata, but or from the Puranas that teach us how to live a dharmic life by using it as something from history. Ardhapati is postulation. You can deduce a person, a healthy person, must be eating at night if you never see them eating in the day. Because they're healthy, that means they're getting food, and because they never eat in the day, therefore they must eat at night. Anupalabdhi, absence. A pot doesn't exist on the table just because we can't see it. The lack of this ability is fun to play with in kids. If you go to very young kids, babies, like less than 1 year old, and you say, ever play this with a kid? Right? When you're here, the child doesn't see you, so he assumes you don't exist. And when you do this, they're like, where? That's the reason kids have so much fun with it. If you study child development, that's the psychological process. Like, wow, you came out of nowhere with us. But that's the reason kids have so much fun playing chupa. Shabda. Specifically, this relates to at that age, Veda, and things that are in Veda. Which, for example, Brahman is all pervasive, and that concept can be traced in Mundukya Upanishad. But there's other than Veda, there's no way to verify Shabda. Aitithyam is tradition. The old fort in New Delhi is believed to have been built by the Pandavas. That's a verifiable account. That's not a verified fact in the modern sense of the word, but that is the thing that's been passed on for generations. Abhavam talks to the absence of existence. I can't see someone that's lying on the other side of a wall. Chishta is about movement. When someone's body language tells us something about that person's thought, so I can deduce that by this movement. Yukti talks about experience. A physician uses yukti to find a remedy with limited information. He listens to your heart and then says you have a heart murmur. It's not because he saw the murmur itself, but through his experience in treating heart issues, he knows. This is some set of pramanas. And how is pramanas used? Pramanas are used to prove as a way for different darshanas to prove their view of the world. If we look at science, science also uses pramanas. They don't explicitly talk about them, but they are used. Postulation is used. Analogy is used. Direct perception is used. Inference is used. Shabda is not used, but Aityas, Etabhya, Etiyam isn't used, Abhavam isn't used, Cheshta is used, Yukti is not used. Right? So science believes in Pramana as evidenced by the what is allowed to prove a scientific theorem. But they don't believe or use all of them. Specifically, Shastra and the Darshanas outline all of them, and then every Darshana says, this is the set we use to prove the thing that we are proving. Now, if we go into Darshanas, what are they? And what do they use? They use and define a specific set of Pramanas that they use, and that's what defines the valid knowledge that they believe to be valid. Vedanta, for example, uses sense perception, inference, scripture, analogy, postulation, non-availability. Charvaka, on the other hand, uses only sense perception, only things that I can directly see. And the Charvaka Darshana does not use anything else. They create a worldview. They talk about a worldview. Where did the world come from? How did it get created? How does it change? What caused it? What are the qualities of nature? For example, Vedanta talks about the universe as appearing as it does because of the limitation of observing faculties, and talks about Brahman as the only cause. Sankhya talks about the universe as not being created or destroyed, but that it can only be transformed, and attributes it to two causes, Purush and Prakriti. Darshanas also talk about the absolute. What is Brahman? As a substratum, essence of all existence manifesting as this world. Vedanta here talks about it being immutable, but yet transforming into the universe. Charvaka, on the other hand, says there is no Brahman because I can't directly see it, and the world is ultimately essenceless. Darshana always addresses the individual self. What's the individual self? They're the attributes of self in the bound and liberated states and in relation with the world. Vedanta talks about self as being undifferentiated from Brahman and liberation. Jadvak says there is no self other than the body, because that's the only thing I can see. Again, direct perception. They talk about binding. The experiences in the phenomenal world, the sources of misery, are the sources of binding, and the laws of action and inaction. Vedanta talks about binding as being caused by ignorance, the veil of Maya, if you will. The self, however, is entirely unbound and free. Vaisheshika talks about binding as dissociation with nature. It's a very different description. And Darshanas always talk about liberation. Specifically, what's the nature of the liberated state? What's the nature of happiness? What's the means to liberation? How do you get there? Vedanta talks about liberation as realizing the true nature of self. That's all you need, is to realize that true nature and you are liberated. Jadvak talks about going out of existence as liberation. So you die and you're liberated. So that's it in terms of slides. Are there any questions?
Yes. It's been a great journey for the past 30 minutes through this shastra and all the texts. Please.
Now you have explained so vividly, and really I appreciate all my appreciation for Krishna Maheshwari for this wonderful talk, because each and everything, as you mentioned about the pramanas, there is one pramana that Kalidasa always says, pramanam antakarana pravruttayah, that our consciousness is the final pramanam, because which I appreciate. And you really, special talk, really, this is useful for many in the way it is scientifically, logically, you prepared this particular talk. I have all my appreciation, and it is informative and very much interesting to each and everyone. So, Krishna Maheshwari, any questions from Dr. Mohan Ananda, Dr. Raji Ananda, who are present, and Dr. R. Narayan Swami, who are present, and Simha and Simi. And Sushi
Ramaya. One question here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Please go ahead.
Hi Krishna, this is Gayatri. Hey, thank you so much for what a fascinating explanation you did. I'm wondering if you could please help me direct where I can read something about brain, nervous system, or anything like that in the Bhagavad Gita. If you could please help me find where I can read about this. I was so fascinated by everything you said today. Thank you so much.
Namaste Gayatri, it's good to hear your voice after such a long period of time. I don't know off the top of my head where the nervous system is described. Some parts of it are described in Srimad Bhagavatam. The reason I know that, as I mentioned, I'm reading it with my kids and I ran into it. But deeper descriptions than what is described there is something that I'm not aware of where it is, other than to know that it is described in depth in Shastra. So I'm not sure I can be of more assistance than there, but maybe Bhagavatam is a starting point.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. We really appreciate it.
The Sushil guy, and we wish we can
hear more knowledge about this and educate us more and more, and we really appreciate it.
And the charts you have prepared are so useful for many of them, because there's about 180,000 people are watching this and hearing this. It's really a useful talk, and it really I appreciate the way you explain the language. You use lucid, and at the same time the topics you have discussed so easy, and because everything is so difficult, even once you go to Veda, it is not that easy to understand, and that you have like Veda Vyasa, who that heap of Vedas, he really classified in the way, that's why he became Veda Vyasa. in the same way, like the modern Veda Vyasa you became, and you really clear picture you have given about the Agamas, Shastras, is really an exactly beautiful journey through Shastras. I appreciate it, and I enjoyed your talk so much, because though we studied Sanskrit, we studied the Vedic literature, still is the vivid description of these things really made me. Ekam sat vipraha bahuda vadanti. That was the real saying of this, and that you explained in such a way that all the agamas and that, and mainly the shat darsanas that you explained so well, and the way you explained about the embryology, that was really in Bhagavatam. I used to recite and I used to understand that the way. And about the brain, which you were always saying, that the Agneyastra, that was also a beautiful explanation you have given. And which I want to say, the Divi Surya Sahasrasya Bhavet Yugapad Utthita Edibha Sadrusi Sasyat Bhasastasya Mahatmanaha. That way, and all the Bhagavad Gita Atma, that Atanoti is Atma description also, everything. And also my appreciation to Srimati Shashi Ji and Sriman Rajesh Maheshwari Ji, the proud parents of our Krishna Maheshwari. I have my appreciation to your parents. And now Sri Simha wants to say a few things. Yeah.
Hi Krishna. So the crux of your talk, I just want to know your the essence, the outcome, or your experience on the question of, I'm assuming that because there's a beyond the body experience, that looking at the depth of which you have explained and the kind of conviction with which you have presented, this is my assumption that there are some kind of a beyond the body experiences that you might have, encountered. So at least, because from my perspective, I have gone through different coincidences, string of coincidences, which I can draw a pattern. So my question, at the end, my question is, I'm at a stage where I feel that most of us is part of the mind, or the what we say as Atma is part of the it's a global connected mind. It's a one mind which people are tapping into. So sorry, I'm not being able to put the question correctly, but my question was, is it just a mind game? So I'm sorry to put it very bluntly, is it this a mind game, or do you think there is an entity apart from the mind that's in the play, which we call as God? Is God just a mind, or is it beyond the mind there is an entity which is controlling all the minds?
Yes, so it is beyond the mind.
That was my question.
That's an easy one.
Okay.
Not to belittle the question, but it's easy because almost every guru of note talks about this topic. And I'm actually going to probably do the worst job of all of them in talking about it, and will refer you to almost anyone for a deeper exposition. Swami Chinmayananji talks about body, mind, intellect, and then Bhagwan being above and beyond that, and Atman being above and beyond that. These days, my kids and I are reading about someone's notes on the talks by Swami Ram in the early 1900s. And so that example is the most fresh in my mind. And the way he describes Atman is that it is infinite. And specifically, we are like reflections of it. And the example he says is, you take a look at a mirror in a wall, and you stand in front of it, and what do you see? You see one of you. Take a hammer to that mirror and break it into two pieces. How many of yourself do you see? You see two. You take a hammer to each of those two pieces, now you have four pieces. How many do you see? You have four. Do and you have 100 pieces. How many of yourself do you see? You have 100. One for each fragment. And so he describes Atma as you, the single, the one. And the mind, the body, the intellect, the instrument, if you will, of who you consider to be you, not who you actually are, but who you consider to be you, as the reflection thinking, I am it, and Atma is something different from me. And me as a reflection in this crooked piece of glass, being different from the other me in the other piece of the glass. And so suddenly there are 100 individuals that think they're all distinctly different, but they're all reflections of one. The other piece he talks about, and now examine it logically, as he says, the Atma is infinite. And because the Atma is infinite, it cannot move. Examine that statement and say, well, if the Atma could move, by definition, that means it went from somewhere where it was to somewhere where it was not, because that's the concept of movement. Well, if there was a space in the first place where it was not, then by definition, it cannot be infinite. So if the thing is infinite, it actually physically can't move because there's no space where it doesn't already exist that it can expand into. So I don't know if that helps at all with their answer. With their question. I would refer to Swami Chinmayananji, Swami Ram, basically any living guru to get a deeper exposition here, because they're all infinitely more deep on this topic than me.
Thank you.
Yeah. And the answer is only Bhagavad Gita is the best answer for them. If they go through in detail, that really a realization it will give, I suppose. And now Dr. Ananda, Raji Ananda, wanted to ask something. She was asking, can you hear my voice? I said, let me see. Dr. Raji Ananda, we cannot. Are you there? Dr. Raji Ananda from Los Angeles. Dr. Mohan Anandaji was the next speaker in the coming second Saturday in the month of May. That was the new speaker is Mohan Ananda, and Dr. Raji Ananda is by profession, she is a neurologist. She sent a message, say, can you hear my voice? That was the same. I don't know why we cannot hear the voice. Now we conclude, because if they have, Krishna, I appreciate your, I call you Krishna only because like my son. So I appreciate your talk, and many who are listening may send some messages. Immediately we pass on those messages, and if they have any questions, and just I will give to you, and you are, you can give answers to them. And today, being a very auspicious day, this is the World Sibilance Day, we call that. So the entire universe is the way we always, Vishwa Manava Saubhratrutvam. That way, Vishwa Manava Saubhratrutvam, that Vedic knowledge alone can give us everything about the universal brotherhood. That with the way Krishna Maheshwari really great talks, lecture we could hear, and I appreciate Krishna Maheshwari for the detailed information in a very lucid way, and also it is for the a layman can also understand, not only the great scholars, Vedic scholars, no, it's an appreciation, even a layman who has no knowledge about the Vedic, and your lecture will definitely help them to have, and also it inspires them to go through in more and more details about this. Thank you so much, Krishna Maheshwari, and all my appreciation to Srimati Shashi and Sriman Rajesh Maheshwari, the proud parents of Krishna Maheshwari. Jai Srimanarayana.
Thank you for having me. Jai Srimanarayana.
Yeah, let me conclude with a Vedic blessing. Om Srihi Varchastvam Ayushyam Arogyam Avidhat Dhanyam Dhanam Pasum Bahubuttalabham Seta Samhatsaram Dirghamayuhu Satamanam bhavati satayuhu ayusevendriyai pratitishtati sakala sanmangalani bhavantu ayur arogya aishwarya abhiruddhi siddhirastu ಉತ್ತರೋತ್ತರ ಅಭಿವೃದ್ಧಿ ಸಿದ್ಧಿರಸ್ತು ಸಕಲ ಸನ್ಮಂಗಳಾನಿ ಭವಂತು ಜಯ ಶ್ರೀ ಕೃಷ್ಣ
ಜಯ ಶ್ರೀ ಕೃಷ್ಣ
ಮಂಗಳಂ ಶ್ರೀ ಕುರುಕ್ಷೇತ್ರೇ ರಣಕ್ಷೋಣಿ ವಿಹಾರಿಣೇ ಪಾರ್ಥಸಾರಥಿ ರೂಪಾಯ ಗೀತಾಚಾರ್ಯಾಯ ಮಂಗಳಂ ಭಾರದ್ವಾಜ ಕುಲಮೃತೋಧತಿ ವಿಧೋ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ ಪೀಠೇ ಸಿತುಃ ಶ್ರೀನಿವಾಸ ರಾಮಾನುಜಾಚಾರ್ಯ ಗುರೋಃ ಆಪ್ತಾಗಮಾನ್ ತದ್ವಯಂ ತತ್ಪಾದಾರ್ಚನ ಧಾರಕಂ ಮನು ಮಣಿ ಧ್ಯಾನೋಲ್ಲಸನ್ಮಾನಸಂ ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣಮಾಚಾರ್ಯಂ ಅಸ್ಮದ್ಗುರುಂ ಅಹಂ ಭಜೆ ಪಾರ್ಥಸಾರಥಿಂ ಗೀತಾಚಾರ್ಯಂ ಅಸ್ಮದ್ಗುರುಂ ಅಹಂ ಭಜೆ ಶ್ರೀಮನ್ನಾರಾಯಣಾಚಾರ್ಯಂ ಅಸ್ಮದ್ಗುರುಂ ಅಹಂ ಭಜೆ ಸರ್ವೇ ಭವಂತು ಸುಖಿನಃ ಸರ್ವೇ ಸಂತು ನಿರಾಮಯಾಃ ಸರ್ವೇ ಭದ್ರಾಣಿ ಪಶ್ಯಂತು ಮಾ ಕಶ್ಚಿತ್ ದುಃಖ ಭಾಗ್ ಭವೇತ್ ಓಂ ಶಾಂತಿ 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 ಜಯ ಶ್ರೀನಾರಾಯಣ